Thank you, Mr Harvey. That comment is now on the record. The next item of business is a debate on motion 7968 in the name of John Swinney on Budget Scotland's number 2 bill at stage 3. As members will be aware, at this point in the proceedings, I am required under standing orders to decide whether or not, in my view, any provision of the bill relates to a protected subject matter, that is, whether it modifies the electoral system and franchise for Scottish parliamentary elections. In the case of this bill, in my view, no provision of the Budget Scotland's number 2 bill relates to a protected subject matter. Therefore, the bill does not require a supermajority to be passed at stage 3. And may I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on John Swinney to speak to and move the motion up to 15 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as we conclude the 2023-24 Scottish Budget Bill, I have reflected carefully on the points raised in Parliament and by a range of organisations and recognise the financial challenges faced at this time by individuals, households, businesses, the third sector and the public sector. I am aware of the challenges faced as we manage our way through this cost crisis, and this budget is designed to do as much as possible to assist at this most difficult moment. None of this is easy. This is by far the hardest budget process that I have led, with the effects of raging inflation being felt against the impact of more than a decade of austerity and Barnett funding down 5% in real terms since 2021-22. I have been open and transparent with Parliament on the budget challenges we are managing, both for this current financial year and for the forthcoming financial year. I indicated to the Finance and Public Administration Committee on the 7th of February the 2022-23 budgetary position continues to improve, and I am now confident of the path to balance for this financial year. This is as a result of careful budget management and taking the hard decisions to live within our means, despite the ferocious pressures created by high inflation. I can also report to Parliament two changes to our funding position that enabled me to make some further steps to increase commitments made in the draft budget. The first of these changes is that it has been confirmed by His Majesty's Treasury that we will receive £125 million of additional funding as a result of Barnett consequentials arising from the UK supplementary estimates. Secondly, I also expect to receive an additional £21 million for 23-24 due to the correction of an error in our UK spending review allocation. Given that I am
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. Could you just clarify the £125 million addition? Is that in the current financial year, and will that be carried forward into the coming financial year and the coming budget?
Cabinet Secretary.
Because I have secured a path to balance for this financial year, because of the late arrival of the supplementary estimate figure, I intend to carry that forward into the next financial year, and I'm about to make funding allocations accordingly as a consequence of the receipt of that finance. Given that I am confident in the financial position for 22-23, which is the point I've just made to Mr Johnson, I'm now able to consider some additional financial commitments for next year. I would like to begin by fully recognising the budget challenges faced by local government. In my budget statement in December, I outlined the government's commitment to work constructively with local government to create an effective partnership to assist in meeting this challenge. I use this debate today to reiterate the government's willingness to engage in that process and to work with local government to undertake the reform necessary to achieve that aim. Along with that commitment to work together effectively, I am committing to provide local government with an additional £100 million to support local authorities and their expenditure. This funding is designed to assist councils in making a meaningful 2023-24 pay offer for non-teaching staff, recognising the critical role that those staff play in delivering frontline services. I hope this will enable a swift agreement in the Scottish Joint Council pay negotiations so that relevant staff receive a pay increase as early as possible in 2023-24. To Mr Fraser.
Murdo Fraser.
I'm very grateful to Mr Swinney for giving way. Can you just clarify, is the money he's just announced part of or the entirety of the money that was announced last week to fund this increased offer that's already on the table to teachers?
Cabinet Secretary.
The £100 million is additional resources to what was announced last week, and I'll come on to explain the issues about the announcements that were made last week. Last week we confirmed that we would provide an additional £156 million from Scottish Government funds to support a new pay offer for teachers, £33 million in this financial year, plus a further £123 million next year. That would see salaries rise by 11.5% from April, and I encourage this proposition to be put to teaching staff for their consideration. This additional funding for 23-24 is on top of the £570 million increase in funding that has already been included in the local government settlement, and takes the total additional funding for next year for local government to £793 million. Presiding Officer, as a result of the decisions in this budget, the total funding available to councils to support local services will be nearly £13.5 billion, plus the revenues from any local decisions on council tax. This is equivalent to a 3% real terms increase compared to the 2022-23 budget bill. We are providing full discretion over £105 million of funding to allow councils to replace national empty property relief with, for example, more localised schemes, and we will also increase the maximum fee levels that a local authority can charge for a penalty charge notice for parking infringements. This represents a comprehensive support package for local government within this challenging financial settlement. It is welcome that progress has also been made in recent days in the Agenda for Change pay discussions, and the Government is undertaking further work to put in place a public sector pay policy prior to the start of the new financial year. Yeah, of course.
Stephen
Kerr. Grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. I'm still not very clear, and I'm sure other colleagues in the Chamber will want to know, where is the £156 million that he has mentioned in relation to the payover? Where has that money come from? Because the Deputy First Minister went to great lengths, not least with my interventions, to make it clear that he didn't have any scope for manoeuvrability. There was no flexibilities. Now, setting aside what he has said in terms of the money, the additional money that's going to local government, where's the £156 million coming from?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've set out already in my earlier remarks that £33 million is coming from this year. Now, that's been available because I've taken decisions to enable me to balance the financial year this year, which was extremely difficult, and find within the budget reductions that I have made and that I've required my colleagues to sign up to free up £33 million this year to put into a teacher's pay deal. So that's where the money's come from this financial year, because I've forced my colleagues to take hard decisions. And then next year, the government is allocating from the existing budget provision that we are making a further £123 million to support. And of course, the passing of the budget today is necessary to enable that money to be put on the table. So I hope there's no mucking about today in not voting in favour of the budget that I'm putting in front of Parliament for consideration. Of course.
Willie Rennie.
The Deputy First Minister says there's £100 million extra on top of the £500 that you announced for local government earlier. He knows those figures are disputed. He must accept that there's going to be significant cuts in local government. Will he accept responsibility for those cuts? Because these are a direct result of the decisions that he's making in his budget.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think what I've tried to explain to Parliament on countless occasions, and I've explained it face-to-face to local government as well, is that the financial comparison that's made is from budget bill to budget bill. From budget bill to budget bill, there is now, as a consequence of the decisions that I have made today, £793 million more available to local government to spend next year than this year. Now, in anybody's book, I think that must be something to welcome. I hope that can be welcomed. And I know Mr. Rennie and I are in a bit of a roll of goodwill just now, so I do hope that he's going to be speaking to endorse what I'm saying, although I see Mr. Cole Hamilton's lectern is up, so that makes me worried that the calm voice of Mr. Rennie will not be heard in this debate. But if he wants to intervene on me in my closing speech to welcome my announcements, he's very welcome to do so. I recognise the difficulties being faced by our island authorities, Presiding Officer, in managing the cost increases facing their inter-islands ferry network due to the effects of inflation and rising fuel prices. This particularly applies in Orkney and Shetland, but to a lesser extent in Argyll and Bute and in Highland. So the second commitment, the government gave a commitment some years ago to fully fund those services. So the second commitment that I make today is that that is a commitment we will honour. We recognise that there are increased costs, and my officials are engaging with the local authorities concerned specifically on the level of funding required, and Parliament will be informed once those decisions have concluded. The third and final announcement I want to make today is that in the earlier committee debate on the budget, I acknowledged the call from Claire Adamson, MSP, Convener of Parliament's Culture and Constitution Committee, to continue to sustain our investment in culture and the arts. The importance of this funding to the well-being of our society has always been passionately championed in Parliament by Fiona Hislop, MSP, as a long-serving Culture Secretary in the Scottish Government. We had asked Creative Scotland to sustain investment next year by utilising £6.6 million from their accumulated lottery reserves in place of a further year of additional grant funding to compensate for generally lower national lottery income. I am now in a position not to require that, and I will provide an uplift of £6.6 million for Creative Scotland for 23-24 to ensure their reserve funding can supplement rather than replace grant funding. That means there is a substantial increase in the Scottish Government funding for culture and major events in the next financial year at a time when our country requires the inspiration that the culture and arts sector can provide for all of us. I've judged that this is the absolute limit of the additional funding that I can provide based on the current financial position. The detail of the budget revisions will be reported to the Parliament as part of the autumn budget revision. Together with our partners in the Scottish Green Party, we offer today a substantial budget package that will help those who need it the most. The budget measures that we bring forward are anchored in three major themes. First, our determination to end child poverty. Second, the need to support the transition of our economy to net zero. And third, the requirement for sustainability in our public services. The budget strengthens our social contract with every citizen of Scotland who will continue to enjoy many benefits not available throughout the United Kingdom. Parliament has already passed the Scottish rate resolution setting the tax rates for next year. The Scottish Government has taken the steps we believe are appropriate to deliver fair and progressive taxation, where we ask those who can afford to contribute more to support investment in our public services to do so. Those principles are reflected in our decision to increase the top and higher rates of taxation by 1 pence each and to levy a higher rate of tax through the additional dwelling supplement. These decisions will mean that the majority of people in Scotland will still pay less in taxation than if they lived in the rest of the United Kingdom. Our progressive choices on Scottish income tax mean that this year the government will deliver record funding of over £19 billion for the health and social care portfolio, with over £2 billion of funding for primary care to deliver and improve primary health care services in the community. The budget also delivers for businesses. The government has responded to the biggest ask from business organisations to freeze the non-domestic rates poundage, saving ratepayers around £300 million next year. The package secures the lowest poundage in the United Kingdom and supports businesses with a package of reliefs worth around £744 million. Presiding Officer, delivering support for people most in need in these difficult times is the foundation of this budget. This Government is doing all we can to support individuals and families, which in turn supports a stronger, more resilient, sustainable economy. The budget commits over £5.2 billion for social security payments to provide support to over 1 million people in Scotland. This represents an increase of over £1 billion on last year's budget. This includes £442 million of investment in the Scottish Child Payment, a key support for eligible families, providing £25 per week per child and only available in Scotland because of the choices this government has made to give a lifeline to families facing difficulty in our country. Of course.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. I thank the Deputy First Minister for the intervention. Can he set out how many families received the Scottish Child Payment before Christmas from the extended from the extension of the Child Payment from over sixes to 16-year-olds?
Cabinet Secretary.
I don't have that number to hand, but I'll endeavour to send that on to Pam Duncan-Glancy. But what I can say is that there are families in this country who are surviving because of the child payment that this government has put in place. There are, of course, other... I would love to take an intervention from Christine Graham.
Christine Graham.
It's not a love match, this. However, what I would say to the Deputy First Minister, I'm shocked that the Tory benches cannot even applaud the child payment, which is needed so much because of Tory austerity and outrageous inflation.
Yep. Cabinet Secretary, and I must ask you to draw your remarks to conclusion.
Christine Graham is a wise and thoughtful Member of Parliament, and I would have thought she shouldn't be that surprised by the Conservatives' lack of reaction to the news of the Scottish Child Payment. Presiding Officer, the decisions in this budget are designed to support those who are facing difficulty, designed to support businesses to make their way through the challenging transition that is required to be made to net zero, and to ensure that our public services can meet the needs of the public. These are difficult decisions in difficult economic times. The budget that's been set out to Parliament enables us to invest in our public services, to ensure a strong boost to local authority funding, and to ensure that we help those who need it the most. I move the budget resolution in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Liz Smith. Up to 11 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I start with my usual generosity of spirit in crediting John Swinney with affording me the opportunity on two different occasions to chat through some issues about the budget process, and can I also thank him for setting out some additional suggestions and policy commitments this afternoon, more of which I'll come to in just a minute. I'm particularly interested in the one regarding Creative Scotland, which I think is important, but he should not forget that he's putting back money that he had just taken away.
Exactly.
But I really do hope that in the two occasions where I was having conversations with John Swinney, that he was at least listening, because what I was saying to him was exactly reflected in the views of so many people across Scotland who are very concerned indeed, and in many cases actually profoundly in disagreement with the direction of travel of this budget because of the wider implications for the economy. And I think it's very interesting to note that in the substantial number of column inches that has been devoted to the First Minister's resignation last week, that a large number of these reflections have been about where Nicola Sturgeon's time in office has left the Scottish economy. And much of that, as well as the conventional statistical analysis that we obviously have from the forecasters, it does not make very much of easy reading for John Swinney. But let's start with what Mr. Swinney himself has said. He has cited recent comments from the Institute of Fiscal Studies that Scotland has the most progressive tax system in the UK. Principally, the fact that the poorest 100% will be 10% will be £580 better off per year in comparison with their counterparts in other parts of the UK, and that Scotland provides a more generous benefit system. And can I just say to Christine Graham that the Tories did actually support the child payment. But Mr. Swinney also points to free prescriptions in Scotland. Yes, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
I wonder if Liz Smith would just clarify the point she's just made about whether the Conservatives would support the Scottish child payment. Does that mean the Scottish Conservatives are going to vote for the budget? Because unless they vote for the budget, the Scottish child payment won't happen.
Liz Smith. Thank you.
What? Mr. Swinney can look at the parliamentary record. We did support that child payment. And a budget, Mr. Swinney, is about far more than just one.
We will hear Ms. Smith.
And can I just go back to these commitments from the Scottish Government, from Mr. Swinney in particular, because he continues to make the case about increased child benefits, about free prescriptions, about free university tuition. But unfortunately for Mr. Swinney, that is by no means the whole picture. The Institute of Fiscal Studies also refers to the political choice, and it is a political choice, that the SNP has made, which means that to fund these policies, the SNP is increasingly reliant upon taxing middle and higher earners much more and widening the differentials between the rest of the UK. And here's an example for the SNP. A young professional, perhaps one of these people in the financial services to whom John Swinney spoke, I have to say, very well just a couple of weeks ago, they're up against it from the start, because staying in Scotland, that professional will pay considerably more in land and buildings transaction tax than the equivalent stamp duty in England. A £400,000 flat in Edinburgh would mean paying £10,000 to £20,000 more a year, and these people will be having a minimum of £500, probably nearer £1,000 extra in income tax and higher council taxes. And these people matter, because as Mr Swinney knows only too well, Scotland is in desperate need of more well-paid jobs. Of course.
Shona Robison.
So, taking that to the next step, presumably Liz Smith will now tell us, if she doesn't think that is right, will she change that and have a different position and therefore have to cut some of the spending that the Deputy First Minister has just laid out? Because that has to be the conclusion of her speech, presumably, and we look forward to hearing it.
Liz Smith.
Can I just say to Shona Robson, and I said this at stage one and I said it at stage two again, I'm well aware of the tight finances that we have just now, but one of the fundamental problems that we have in Scotland just now is that we do not have sufficient money to grow the economy, because the tax take and the productivity is not reflected sufficiently high to be able to make these. How marvellous would it be one day that this Parliament can actually have lower taxes than other parts of the UK? But at the moment, we can't do that. Now, Mr. Yes, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to Liz Smith for giving way for a second time. I'm interested in her economic thinking here, because I think the quickest way to grow an economy is to grow population. And that would be helped if we had a more sympathetic migration regime. And just now, every sector I speak to in the business community complains about the lack of people because of the restrictions of Brexit. When are the Conservatives going to sober up and recognise that migration is the problem that is undermining economic growth in our society?
Liz Smith.
Well, Mr Swinney and I have had this debate before. He knows my own views on Brexit. But can we get to the absolute nub of this? And can I go back to some committee comments? In fact, I think I have them right here. At stage two, Mr Swinney said that there were three things that he felt needed to happen. The first was, and I don't disagree with any of these three things, he said that there had to be a development of entrepreneurship. That's right. He also said that when it came to the necessity of productive regional developments in the economies, that was very important to growth. It is. So I question, why is it, Mr Swinney, and can I just refer to a speech that was made by your colleague Richard Lockhead back on the 7th of February, I think it was, who completely rejected any of the levelling up fund because he felt that it wasn't doing Scotland any good. That levelling up fund is there precisely because it is trying to help regional economies. And he should perhaps ask himself why it is that so many of his colleagues in local government are so keen to get their hands on levelling up. And the other thing, the third thing that he said, was that it was vital to get to the situation of economic inactivity and improving some of that. Now, these are the three things that Mr Swinney said himself. None of that, Mr Swinney, is going to happen unless we are able to grow the economy. And what I'm asking you to do is to look at the other side of the economy. Yes, it's absolutely the right thing when it comes to helping people who are vulnerable, but we have to make sure that we are also helping those who are at the very productive end of Scotland and who want to come and live and work and invest in Scotland, because that is as important as looking after our vulnerable communities. And I think we also have to ask about some of the infrastructure commitments too, because Mr Swinney said that by 2030 there would be £8 billion extra as a result of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. But I ask them to consider whether that will happen if major infrastructure projects, such as dualling the A9, so critical to improving road safety for all the reasons that so many MSPs, Murdo Fraser and Fergus Ewing most prominent amongst them, because that is essential to growth and productivity as well. Yes, Bill.
Michelle Thompson.
Liz Smith for giving way, and it's a theme that I've often questioned about. In terms of additional and what I would regard as proper capital borrowing powers, is she today willing to support my call for that? Because we all agree that infrastructure projects are fundamental to growth in the economy.
Liz Smith.
Well, Michelle Thompson knows my own views on that, that there are discussions to be had, but if it's capital borrowing just for the sake of expanding that capital borrowing, no, I don't agree with that. But there are circumstances where I think we have to look at the arrangements within the fiscal framework, and that's obviously up for negotiation fairly shortly. Presiding Officer, can I come to the issue of what we argued very fervently and continue to argue when it comes to the National Care Commission proposal? There are now four committees in this Parliament that have taken evidence on this basis. And there, it is very difficult indeed to find any stakeholders whomsoever who are in favour of this proposal. Now, we ask again, even at this very late stage, that that money could be reallocated to the front line of local government, because they're at the front of delivering health and social care in any case, because I really don't see where the credibility is in this proposal, given that so many people are saying that it is unworkable. And that's an issue that I think has got cross-party support. And I think, as I say, even at this late stage, then the Deputy First Minister should be considering that. We also welcomed the announcement that the Scottish Government is freezing non-domestic business rates, and we also noted as a result of the measures announced by the Chancellor to reduce the rates burden on business, there was £222 million of Barnett consequentials available, which should have gone to the 75% rates relief package that is available elsewhere. But Mr Swinney told me that that cost an extra £154 million, which he doesn't have. But he would have had that and should have had that if there had been a whole lot of extra money available from the SNP over quite some period of time, let's be honest, had it not been wasted on vast sums of taxpayers' money on failed government projects. Presiding Officer, can I close in the fact that I think Mr Swinney was right when he expressed his frustrations at the difficulties forced upon him by the UK mini-budget last September, accompanying all the other difficulties. He described that, if I recall, as the height of incompetency. But can I take him much closer to home when he declares that this budget predicament has been caused by Westminster? Because that is just not true. Yes, this budget was going to be difficult and tough, but many of the current budgetary problems that have been made right here in Scotland by a government that has for months, if not years, been well out of touch with public opinion when it comes to the economy.
Thank you. I now call on Daniel Johnson, up to 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So we've been away for a week. Has much changed since a week last Thursday? See that the First Minister has already left in terms of this debate. But, you know, this last week has not just been a long time in politics. It makes this budget decision faintly ridiculous, because this is not a budget that will last. I don't see any of the leadership candidates, once selected, leaving the budget well alone. It will last as long as the next summer budget revision, because we already have leadership candidates saying what they would do differently. We had one candidate, it says in my speech here, denouncing cuts being made to Creative Scotland. So, but rather than that, I think I should just congratulate Ash Denham on her first victory of her leadership campaign. And indeed, we have another ambitiously pronouncing the need for more social prescribing, presumably to be delivered through local government, and I'm guessing that would need more funding. And of course, in the last 24-hour period, it's become very unfashionable to agree with Kate Forbes. But let me agree with her on this. This government does need to focus on what really matters, people, the NHS and the cost of living. And therein lies the problem. I do not think that the blame for that lack of focus lies simply with this budget or the Deputy First Minister, because the issues that we face are an accumulation of decisions over 15 budgets, three of which Ms Forbes set herself. And at the heart of these indecisions lies a lack of detail and transparency. Now, I welcome the additional funds for teachers' pay, but when we make proposals, the obvious questions come forward about where the money comes from, what will be cut in order to afford it. But the reality is the only place that these budget changes are written down is in the official report yet to be written. But I would ask the specific questions. Will the £100 million fund the 2.5% increase for non-teaching staff that is being funded by the other money elsewhere? And given Mr Swinney's protestations, would he acknowledge the IFS analysis that shows that non-ring-fenced funding for local government has declined in this budget by 2%? And if he does, where does that leave that decline after this budget revision? Is it 1%? Because I think that's roughly where it would be. But ultimately, budgets and this budget process will only work if we have details and transparency. We were told that Derek's magic money so far was a thing of the past, and yet suddenly we have this announcement with no detail and no real ability to scrutinise. I'm happy to go away.
Emma Roddick.
I'm grateful to the member for taking an intervention, and firstly I'd suggest that if he wants to have a say in the SNP leadership contest, he should join this party. But secondly, the reason that these decisions have had to be made so late is because this government can't count on the money that's coming from the UK government. So would you maybe support our calls for greater fiscal flexibility here?
Here.
Daniel Johnson.
Well, the government can't count. We have it there. No, budgets rely on transparency, and this is just one example of the lack of transparency. We don't have the detail in terms of what is discretionary funding, what is demand-led, what is to be paid or spent on people, what is even to be spent on energy bills. We don't have that clarity. If you want serious discussion negotiation, we need greater transparency. But indeed, John Swinney in Truth Today has been asked to perform an invidious task, to pass a budget that will almost certainly not last, and one that is being asked to deal with the consequences of decisions being made by other people. And indeed, in all seriousness, I'd like to thank him for his engagement through this process, because while we do not agree on the specifics on this budget, I think there is agreement about the broader need for strategic choices. And I do accept the huge pressures being faced by the government in setting budgets at a time when costs are spiralling and negotiations regarding pay are complex. But this budget did need to fix social pay. The front door of the NHS is blocked because the back door is shut. We cannot get well people home for want of social care workers. But this budget does nothing to stop, to fix that issue. Because I know that ultimately John Swinney agrees with that analysis about in terms of the problem with the NHS. And this budget does nothing to stop the long-term decline in local services, undermined by over a decade of cuts, squeezes and central government diktats. And I suspect he also agrees with the need of much more fundamental and urgent reform about how we deliver those vital local services, services which ultimately will impact on our ability to deliver social care. So I make no apology for our focus on social care pay through this budget process. It is right that for these workers who do an invaluable job, that they get wages that reflect that. It is an immediate issue for the NHS, but it is not a new issue. And that's why it needed to be fixed. So our proposals were costed, they were sourced, and they were affordable. But more importantly, at a time when delayed discharges costing the NHS £150 million a year, it is vital for preventing catastrophe in our valued NHS. But instead, this government is offering just 40 pence additional an hour, less than the 50 pence offered in last year's budget, at a time when inflation is running at almost three times the 3.8% that this increase represents. And yet what they do is continued with their flawed plan for a national care service. Apparently 65 million is what will be spent in this budget, not that we would know from the details actually in the budget. £65 million spent on plans and centralisation rather than delivering care. So even if you don't accept our plans, £65 million, what would that deliver? It would take social care workers' pay to over £11 an hour. So don't take our plans, at least change yours. Do something that puts money into the pockets of social care workers. But this budget will simply make the problems, the recruitment and retention of social care workers worse and the crisis in the NHS deeper. But the issue of pay is not restricted to care or the NHS. It is emblematic of this government's inability to deal with strategic issues, because low pay is endemic in the public sector. There are almost 300,000 public sector workers in Scotland earning less than £15 an hour. There are around 20,000 people in the public sector earning less than the real living wage. And I would simply say this: you cannot build public services on low pay. And when the public sector is close to half the economy, this impacts on the overall health of our economy. Wage and employment growth are critical to our public finances, so we need a strategic workforce plan that plans for jobs and wages in the public sector, that manages capacity and capabilities that we need in our public sector workforce. That is why Audit Scotland called for a strategic workforce plan. But this budget does nothing. It does not even have a public sector pay policy. Happy to.
Alex Cole Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Daniel Johnson for taking my intervention. In the subject of public sector pay, does he agree with me that an 11.3% increase over 2 years for our hard-working teaching staff, as brought about by great fanfare from the Deputy First Minister, actually amounts to a real terms cut both last year, or this coming year, and the year preceding us? And actually, it's derisory and a slap in our face for our hard-working teachers who are having to accept this pay cut in the teeth of the aftermath of COVID.
Daniel Johnson.
I welcome Mr. Cole Hamilton's intervention, and indeed over the last decade, teachers' real terms pay has come under severe pressure. So we need to look very closely at the realities of this and the real terms numbers that these represent. So ultimately, what does this budget say? What does it speak to? What does it actually say about not just this last year, but over the 15 years of the SNP and 8 years of Nicola Sturgeon? Because this budget is the sum of this party and her time in office. And how will it be remembered? Well, probably ferries. But not just the hulks that lie unfinished and that will cost hundreds of millions more than budgeted, but each of the ferries that should have been launched every year for the last 10 years to replace the fleet in a timely manner. Because this year alone, we've seen two ferries withdrawn because of rust. Rust leaving islanders high and dry, because this government can't make the decisions and the long-term planning need to maintain islanders and their connectivity. Perhaps 1140 hours would be the First Minister's most significant achievement, but even that is a half-formed policy, because the number of people working in local authority settings is up, the overall numbers working in childcare is down. We've lost almost a quarter of childminders, and the total number of settings has fallen. So childcare is vitally important, but this good objective has been undermined by poor policy and poor funding. And when we look at local government, we see the real damage caused by this government. More and more funding tied up by Scottish Government direction and ring fencing. COSLA claims this budget amounts to a cut when these things are excluded. And indeed, the IFS agrees with them. But when you look below the headline numbers, the results are even more alarming. The long-term erosion to basic services is stark. Planning and development budgets have been halved in the last 10 years. Road budgets cut by a third, culture by a third, and housing by almost 40%. Housing that is so vital for delivering against poverty, for developing regional economies, and for enabling us to achieve net zero. No wonder shelter have been protesting outside this lunchtime. So I would set one challenge to the leadership contest. They're right to pick holes at the focus and direction of this government. But I challenge them, if they're serious about change, vote with us against this budget. Because it's only by real change that we will deliver the change that Scotland needs, and Labour is serious in delivering.
I now call on Alex Cole Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And before I start, can I remind the Chamber of my interest that I'm married to a teacher who is a member of the EIS trade union. Presiding Officer, we've been straight with the Deputy First Minister throughout the budget process, and I am grateful, as Liz Smith was, for the access he's given us. We approached those discussions in good faith. I deployed the legendary goodwill of Willie Rennie at stage one in these debates. But if the budget package was right, we would support it. We stood by that. We have voted for previous budgets and voted this year for the income tax resolution. In our meetings, I was very clear with the Deputy First Minister about the different choices that we as Liberal Democrats would make. I talked constructively about the issues that we care about. Now, I think it's only right I do give credit to the one issue that the government seemed to have heeded us on, but it is just the one issue, and that is in particular the commitments to ferry funding in our island communities. When I met with Shetland Island Council just a couple of weeks ago, they pointed out that the actual increased costs of running their ageing fleet have gone up by £5 million. So I don't doubt the magnitude of the ask, and I hope that the government won't cut short that quantum. But the government hasn't budgeted to the degree they needed to win our full support in this. This budget is just not good enough. There are decisions that we cannot look past, and that is a matter of some regret. It is essential to step up the efforts to resolve the crisis in our social care sector. That would relieve delayed discharges and some of the pressure, disruption and cost being heaped upon the National Health Service. Despite the evidence and reports of multiple committees of this Parliament, local government, trade unions, charities, frontline workers, the National Care Service Bill has still not yet been abandoned. This budget was an opportunity to pull forward national bargaining and deliver fair work years ahead of the SNP and Greens' current schedule. The budget was an opportunity to put money into frontline services and staff instead of putting a significant deposit down on a vast and unnecessary £1 billion bureaucracy. Now, I was pleased to see that at least one of the SNP leadership contenders, and we've heard about this already, has recognised that the bill must be halted. I suspect that others in the SNP quietly agree with them. Presiding officer, when the NHS recovery plan was launched, one in five children were waiting too long for mental health children. That is now one in three. Young people are still battling with the long shadow of lockdown. The rising cost of living is but adding to their pressure. To freeze the mental health budget on top of the £38 million cut this year is a receipt for more missed targets and scandalous long waits. This is the government that promised to clear mental health waiting lists for children by March. Presiding officer, that's next week. We are nowhere. I'm still disappointed that throughout the 158 pages of the draft budget, there was not one word on long COVID, nor was there anything on long COVID in the Deputy First Minister's remarks. Almost 200,000 people are suffering this debilitating condition, and the country is suffering too. We have a downturn, low productivity and labour shortages. Scotland needs the talents of everyone to grow the economy and to make our country fairer. We have uncovered that the government is turning down requests from health boards for more money to help with long COVID, cash that could have been helped to get people well and get on with life. Turning to education, there can be few more pressing issues than that of the school gates being locked because of strike action. It is the last thing that our teachers want to do. But the government has left them no other choice. School pupils have already lost 2.1 million days of education during this dispute alone. That's on top of the huge disruption caused to them in 2 years of pandemic lockdowns. And this will double if an agreement is not reached. All the while, life-qualifying exams come over the horizon. Now, I mentioned in my intervention to Mr Johnson that the government announced, or the Deputy First Minister announced with some fanfare, the increase in budget to allow for an 11.3% increase over 2 years. But, Deputy Presiding Officer, I need not remind you, inflation is a year-on-year event, and if it is 14% this year and 14% that last year, then 11.3% over 2 years is asking our teachers to take a significant pay cut last year and a much bigger pay cut next year. It just won't wash. To get Scottish education back on track, we need to get the basics right. That means boosting paying conditions for staff, permanent contracts, more time for lesson planning, cutting class sizes so that pupils get the support that they deserve. Instead, we still have a government spending £17 million on national testing every year for children as young as four and five. Now, we have a budget which school leaders in Scotland say will lead to class sizes increasing and subjects being removed from the curriculum. And the announcement a fortnight ago of a fresh regime of penalties further undermines local government. The Education Secretary is treating councils like the enemy who are determined to cut teacher numbers. That's nobody's wish. The way to protect teacher numbers is to properly resource our local government and education departments. The IFS said that even if the council tax is increased by 5%, local authorities will still face significant real-term cuts to their budget, even with the extra £100 million announced today, because my colleague Willie Rennie was exactly right when he intervened on the Deputy First Minister to say that the maths being used underpinning all of this by the government are disputed by COSLA, and they are still staring down the barrel of some pretty significant cuts. The fresh ring-fencing regime means that even deeper cuts to housing, libraries, leisure centres, roads and waste. And frankly, I'm surprised that the Green Party have gone along with this. This is a party that shared our belief in the European Charter for Local Self-Government. It's a charter that says that political and financial independence of local authorities must always be upheld. We agreed with the Greens that priorities and policies must be developed and delivered in partnership, and we were told this government would value the unique role of local government. Finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, I want to say a word about capital spending. There is nothing in this budget that is moving the debate on further in terms of the urgent programme of public works we need to see to insulate every home in Scotland. £10 million extra in the year is not going to cut the mustard. In the face of a climate emergency and surging costs of living, we need to insulate our homes in Scotland to help our people. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole Hamilton. We now move to the open debate. I call first Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Douglas Lumsden for around 6 minutes. Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Each year, finance secretaries are responsible for making the difficult decisions governing requires. Since the SNP took office in 2007, fiscal challenges to contend with included the financial crash, austerity and COVID, requiring careful husbandry to protect public services and deliver prosperity. However, the scale of the challenge is now even greater. Pandemic recovery, war in Ukraine and volatile energy prices exacerbated by UK failure to retain adequate gas storage facilities, Brexit and vicious Tory fratricide at Westminster have put a match to the finances and credibility of UK PLC with predictable knock-on consequences for this Parliament's budget. In this context, Professor Francis Ruin of the Economic and Social Research Institute told the Finance Committee that it is the responsibility of government to provide as much certainty as it can to businesses and households. And this budget delivers that. The Scottish Government is foregoing £308 million in revenue to freeze a business rates poundage, while ensuring 100,000 businesses pay no rates at all, keeping the shutters up on shops and staff in work. All Scottish benefits were upgraded in line with consumer price index inflation. The SNP government introduced the Scottish Child Payment, unique to these islands. Initially £10 a week, it has increased by 150% to £25 in a year and will lift 50,000 children out of poverty, which the Joseph Rowntree Foundation described as, and I quote, a watershed moment for tackling poverty in Scotland the rest of the UK should take notice of. Labour suggested only a fiver per child 4 years ago. Finding decent employment and career progression remains the best way to improve household finances and well-being. I'm therefore pleased the Cabinet Secretary has committed £69.7 million to the Parental Employability Support Fund, providing intensive personalised support for parents to gain work, upskill, retrain, increase family income and lift themselves out of poverty. The thumping increase of £1,117.7 million in health and social care spending is also welcome, as is £100 million extra for our councils. Presiding Officer, opposition parties also have opportunities throughout the budget process to set out a vision, not an unfunded wish list, but a series, thought-out, costed and balanced budget detailing their very own difficult choices to at least pretend to be an alternative government in waiting, but we don't see it. Astonishingly, at stage one, Miles Briggs talked about housing shortages and homelessness without at any point acknowledging UK Tory cuts of 9.8% this year to our capital budget, almost half a billion pounds, with a further £185 million next year at a time of rocketing construction inflation. That takes some brass neck. Much as the Tories bluster and deflect, UK financial chaos has impacted Scotland's budget, and what a farce it's been. Three prime ministers in 3 months, managerial turnover one might see, a football club battling relegation. A mini budget that removed the Office for Tax Simplification, the cap on bankers' bonuses, and brought the entire UK economy to the brink of meltdown, scrabbling to find billions to shore up public finances and avoid a collapse in pension funds. Policies Tories in this chamber demanded the SNP emulate. I'm happy to give way. I was hoping to give way to Miles Briggs, frankly, but I'll take you, actually.
I'm always
I think
delighted.
By you, he means,
always
you,
delighted
Mr.
that Mr. Gibson accepts an intervention. I'm afraid his narrative is somewhat out of date. I don't know if he's checked the news today, but last month the UK public finances were £5.4 billion in surplus. The UK economy is doing much better than the doom and gloom being predicted by Mr. Gibson and his colleagues on those benches.
Mr.
Stuff
Gibson.
From Mr. Fraser. What we have is a national debt across the UK of £2.6 trillion, £91,000 per UK household. Debt interest payments alone will be £116 billion this year, says the Office for Budget Responsibility, a figure five times Scotland's entire public sector pay bill. Sadly, the party that brought us Truss and Quarting doesn't have the humility to admit it was wrong and is moving swiftly on. From Labour, it's the same old, attempting to be all things to all people. Increasing hourly social care pay to £12 would cost £275 million, as set out in correspondence to the Finance Committee, excluding millions more required for social care workers employed by local authorities. And of course, since early 2021, Labour has demanded we aim for £15 an hour, a figure not increased by inflation since, incidentally. This on top of hundreds of millions of pounds of demands like having rail fares and more money for councils without saying how much more. As always, Labour offers no credible source as to where the money should come from. And indeed, they once actually favoured 3% annual top slicing of all council budgets. Now, Daniel Johnson suggested at stage one that £95 million be transferred from the National Care Service. However, as the DFM made clear, only a maximum of £50 million is committed to the NCS next year. Another £100 million from Labour would come from somewhere in the NHS, apparently. Throwing a bone to the future, though, Mr Johnson suggested scrapping the council tax and non-domestic rates and replacing them with fairer and more progressive levies that could raise as much as £450 million. But what are these new levies? Who would pay? This is uncosted fantasy politics. Scotland sees through it. In Wales, Labour rightly blame Westminster cuts, but in Scotland they're blind to Tory failings. In all four Stage 1 Labour speeches, and again today, there was not a single word, not one, from Labour criticising the Tories. It seems obvious that Labour's Holyrood ambition is for a Labour-Tory-Lib Dem coalition like we already see de facto in Edinburgh City and five councils. Meanwhile, the SNP delivers. On taking office, social care workers were paid a measly £5.35 an hour, and a year Labour tried to hand back £1.5 billion to Westminster. Today's budget sees £100 million of investment to bring the hourly wage to £10.90, 104% increase in carers pay over 16 years, almost twice inflation. Where it could act, what did Labour do? In Glasgow City Council, Labour's big decision was which law firm to give £3 million of city funding to deny for years equal pay female care workers deserved, a matter the SNP put right. Presiding officer, this year's budget necessitated a hard choice to help people through difficult times, combating child poverty, protecting public services, meeting net zero ambitions. Sadly, this challenging year isn't a blip. We'll be here again next year and beyond as long as this parliament remains hitched to Westminster and as long as we cut ourselves off from our European partners. We'll be locked into a slow decline Scotland's people don't deserve. We should bid farewell to Westminster chaos, set an independent course that can realise Scotland's full potential. Support the budget.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. I now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, this does feel a bit like Groundhog Day. Although in the film, Phil predicted six more weeks of winter, in Scotland we face 3 years more of doom and gloom under this SNP Green devolved government. Extra money for local government at the last minute from the Derek Mackay sofa, once again, just like Groundhog Day. Higher taxes, reduced local government spending, lack of support for business, and no focus on economic growth paint a dismal and bleak picture for the economic prosperity of Scotland over the next couple of years, regardless on who the new leader is. And today, Presiding Officer, I want to concentrate on the crisis that is facing our colleagues in local government. Regardless of what the Deputy First Minister says today, it is a crisis. And I've been in local government and now Scottish Parliament for 6 years. And budget time is always one of the most depressing of times. We have the Scottish Government telling us how great the local government settlement is. And we have local government setting the record straight. And then some last-minute cash, just like we've seen today. It's hardly a case of partnership working. And this year is no different.
I will give way. John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. Is he going to tell us that money should come from the NHS to go to local government, or would he like to raise taxes more?
Douglas Lumsden.
No, I'm going to tell him that money should come from the National Care Service. Yeah, yeah. The Deputy First Minister was quoted as saying, we are providing councils with a real-term budget increase of 1.3% next year. It's now been revised upwards to 3%, which it sounds great until you look at the details. Of the extra cash, most of this is for the pay settlement. £105 million is for the devolution of empty property business rates relief. So not new money, just an accounting exercise that has moved this from a central government spend to a local government spend. Other cash for the Scottish Government political priorities, and then, as Cosla have said, we believe that local government will see an uplift of only £71 million once policy commitments are taken into account. And this is far below the levels required to ensure service continues at the current levels. £71 million, and I don't see that changing after the Deputy First Minister's intervention today.
Audrey Nicholl.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. I wondered if, just in his analysis, he would remember that during his time as one of the leaders in Aberdeen City Council, he left the council with debt of £2 million that the people of Aberdeen are still paying off. And as I recall, that was for projects that still, many of which still have to be delivered.
Douglas Lumsden, I can give you the time back.
Oh, well, I feel I led a council of ambition, unlike the SNP Lib Dem coalition that's in place just now. So forget about the nonsense of real-term budget increase. This budget is a cut to local government funding when these extra commitments are factored in. COSLA has made a series of statements over the last few months with dire warnings over the future of services within our local communities. They've described the budget settlement as having a detrimental impact on vital local services. So we've heard a lot about legacy over the last week. Well, that is some legacy. Cuts to local services to the detriment of our communities. And we know that many local authorities are planning for significant job losses as a result of this cut to their budget. Up to 7,000 jobs, according to the COSLA report, should this budget be passed today. Many of these will be in education, which we know to be in crisis. And yet the Scottish Government has now come in with threats and intimidation. Rather than funding councils properly, they are threatening to withhold funding for any that don't toe the line. Presiding Officer, can you imagine the outcry if the UK government imposed as much conditions that this government imposes on the local government budget? This is shocking behaviour from this government. Instead of valuing and working with our local government friends, they threaten and intimidate. Instead of meeting them and discussing a way forward, COSLA leaders have been faced with a blank wall, with ministers refusing to meet with leaders, turning their backs on local government. I do welcome the U-turn of the Creative Scotland funding today, and hopefully now recognise the value in culture. I didn't hear anything about men's sheds. SNP members have signed your bill, Presiding Officer, condemning cuts to the men's shed budget, and yet today they will vote to cut that funding. We always get warm words from the SNP colleagues, but when push comes to shove, they will fall in line and vote for these appalling measures. This budget does not plan for growth, it plans for decline. Decline in our public services, decline in our local councils, decline in our communities, towns and villages. Decline in the money in the pockets of hard-working Scots. And yet they continue to pursue policies that everyone thinks is a bad idea, the National Care Service being the prime example. I can only hope that the new First Minister swiftly puts a stop to that policy and diverts the money to local authorities. Now, welcome Ash Reagan's comments in the press today that she would pause the rollout so we can have a proper co-design process. Trade unions can see it. Even the SNP backbenchers see it. The National Care Service is a disaster waiting to happen, and it will be the Scottish taxpayer that will have to pick up the tab. Delaying this vanity project until we have a new First Minister is surely the most sensible approach. In closing, Presiding Officer, I once again appeal to the Deputy First Minister to reconsider, even at this late stage. He should meet with council leaders to discuss the concerns firsthand. Listen to what the impact of this appalling cuts to their finances will mean for the essential services within our communities. The impact on early prevention and detection. The impact on social care, education, school build programmes, refuse collection, community funding, men's sheds, music tuition in schools. Reallocate the money set aside for the National Care Service, plan for growth, reinstate the cuts to the men's sheds, and give local authorities the money that they need to continue to deliver the vital services we all rely on. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. I can advise the Chamber we've got a little bit of time in hand. I think most speakers so far have taken interventions. I would encourage them to continue to do so, but discourage people making sedentary interventions and hurling abuse around the Chamber. And that goes for those sitting on all benches. At this point, I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Sarah Boyack, around 6 minutes. Ms. Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Sorry, just give me a minute. Getting a tut-tut there, I see. Right. The Scottish Government and the Acting Finance Secretary in particular have faced huge challenges with this budget and have acted in the interests of the majority of the Scottish people. And this balancing that needs to be done is very difficult. And so I'm fully supportive in this budget bill. High inflation, a lack of borrowing powers and a decades-long failure by successive UK governments to address the issues of economic growth. I think the Acting Finance Secretary has done a remarkable job in constructing a budget that protects Scotland from some of the worst potential effects of a declining UK. If I can, I just wanted to take an opportunity to address a regular theme of mine, not directly relevant to today's budget, but in the wider picture. And that's the need to do much more to support women entrepreneurship to drive economic growth and social equality. I have, in both the Finance and the Economy Committees, regularly called for better data collection and analysis and a recognition of the many cultural barriers to participation. And we really need to remove all the barriers to women entrepreneurship. So I was delighted that yesterday the report of Anna Stewart and Mark Logan entitled Pathways, a New Approach for Women in Entrepreneurship, was published. And it's an excellent report. I also want to congratulate Kate Forbes, whose initiative it was as Cabinet Secretary, and her appointment of Anna Stewart to lead the inquiry. The 31 recommendations, in my opinion, all deserve support. Some of the historic barriers to women, which I myself experienced, such as the misogynistic belief that having a young family should constrain the ambitions of women, but not men, are directly addressed, including the calls for various education initiatives. Now, I would note that the recommendations cross over different portfolio areas and will require significant responses from a wide range of institutions, including from Scottish Enterprise Councils, primary schools to universities. What is proposed is welcome, but the institutional challenges will be very real and must be faced. And so any incoming First Minister or indeed the Acting Finance Minister will need to ensure appropriate ministerial oversight of the report's implementation. The success of creating more women entrepreneurs will undoubtedly, and this is my key point, help our economic growth and therefore will help sustain government finances. But it needs the wholehearted support of all branches of government to both implement and monitor the recommendations. Yes, of course.
Liz Smith.
I really agree with what Michelle Thompson is saying about entrepreneurship, and she spoke very eloquently in the debate we had about women in science. Can I just ask her what her reflections are on the recent report that's come out from Mark Priestley, which is suggesting in schools that because of the squeeze on subject choice, that is going to be a real problem in trying to inspire more young women into some of these areas?
I think this came out in that debate, the challenges of continuing to encourage young women into particular both to go into STEM and stay in STEM remain fairly acute, and it's something that we need to keep being focused on, in my opinion. So if the Stewart report is a cause for cautious optimism, we know the state of the UK economy is not. We've heard it quoted before. It's expected to be the worst performing state economically amongst the G7, the G20, and worse than even sanctions hit Russia. UK economic growth lagged behind the average for large and small advanced economies over the last four decades. Small advanced economies experienced cumulative economic growth that was double that of the UK between 1999 and 2019. Now, these are all facts that can't be chased away. Measured by GDP per head, by 2019, the gap between the small economy average and the UK has grown to more than £12,700 a person. And I would squarely point out, again, for the record, that these fiscal powers for this type of economic growth reside squarely with the UK government. In this context, the efforts of the Acting Finance Secretary should be applauded. And I've also talked before about the ways in which the devolution settlement ties his hands in multiple ways. We referenced earlier, and I thank Ms Smith for taking my intervention vis-à-vis restriction on borrowing powers, and I agree that the terms of reference for the fiscal framework may look at this again, but it's taken, if you don't mind me saying, a very, very long time, and I frankly don't think the Scottish Tories need to be told what to think by the London Tories in calling for increased targeted capital revenue powers, raising powers. At the same time, we have to acknowledge the UK government's hell-bent on furthering legislation that's a direct threat to the limited economic powers we have. We need full fiscal freedom to act in Scotland's interest. This is about growth, this is about job creation, it's about wealth creation, and is utterly vital. Last point I would make, we've hardly mentioned it today, but Brexit. We have to abandon the Little Englander mentality in favour of re-engaging fully with Europe and the wider world. Every day, Brexit damages the lives of Scots, putting barriers in the way of Europe and destroying supply chains. This is damaging the prospects for economic growth and places an added burden in a multitude of ways on Scotland's finances. So, Scotland needs full borrowing powers, it needs a complete range of fiscal powers and a reinvigorated international outlook. I think we could call that independence.
Thank you, Ms Thompson. I now call Sarah Boyack to be followed by John Mason for around 6 minutes, Ms Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I first of all refer members to my register of interests? This budget will not address the cost of living crisis that our constituents are having to deal with, and the aftermath of the Tories trashing our budget, trashing our country's economy, and the cumulative impact of funding cuts to our councils over the last decade, which has hit our communities hard, and even SNP councillors who are leaders are admitting that this year. So I want to highlight the damage that this budget will do to my constituents in Edinburgh and the Lothians. Because in the Lothians, we've seen waiting times for our accident emergency, for cancer services, for operations rising. And we've seen our health services under pressures for years. And NRAC means that we don't see the funding for services to address the pressures in our region. And because our health services are already at capacity, we urgently need new investment to ensure that the increasing population we have in our region will be supported. Because we will have 84% of Scotland's projected growth by 2030. So we need that investment now. And new buildings like the Eye Pavilion are vital, but it's also about investing in GP services to support patients, not cuts. It's also about ensuring we've got NHS dentists. Earlier this year, dentists warned that there could be a wholesale exodus of dentists from the profession. So there's a serious risk that dental treatments will only be available to those that can afford it. And that is not acceptable. And we urgently need action to deliver care. Now, that's been mentioned already today by several people. People need the care and dignity they need in the place that's best for them, whether that's at home or in a home. And that means funding. So it's time for the SNP Green Government to admit failure and stop their centralising National Care Service, which doesn't just cost a huge amount of money, £1.3 billion, but it doesn't deliver the additional carers we need, it won't see them being paid £15 an hour, and crucially, it doesn't give them new career opportunities that we need to keep people in that vital sector. And as Daniel Johnson said, the failure to deliver care for people when they need it is hitting our NHS as hard because people are stuck in hospital, which isn't good for them and their health, and it's also limiting access to NHS services. So this budget does not address that issue. And we're also seeing the impact of the failure to invest in housing. Earlier this month, I met with Shelter, and they painted a grim picture of the housing emergency we are facing in Scotland and Edinburgh in particular. If you'd like to comment on Edinburgh's housing crisis, I'd be delighted to take your intervention.
Through the chair, Ms Boyack, Emma Harper.
Thank you very much, Sarah Boyack, for taking an intervention. I can't really comment on Edinburgh because I actually am a South Scotland region MSP. I am interested to hear about what she thinks about the impact of Brexit on carers that are needed in our caring communities across the whole of Scotland, including in their own area in Edinburgh Lothians.
Sarah Boyer.
Well, we've got a shortage of care workers right across Scotland, but you look at the housing crisis in Edinburgh and you look at their rocketing rents, you look at the cost of people who want to buy a home, it's impossible, and people have to leave the city and move further out into the region. So the basic cost of living crisis is fundamental, and that's why not delivering £15 an hour is not going to help our care service recover. So we need urgent action, and it is not in this budget. The £133 million cuts in investment to energy efficiency our homes announced in November is appalling. During a cost of living crisis, when people's bills are rocketing and we need radical action to address the climate crisis, it defies belief. So, a little bit of good news in the budget. I want to note today's U-turn on what would have been the biggest percentage cut to the budget in the culture area. And it would have put a quarter of the regularly funded organisations by Creative Scotland directly at risk. So I want to thank the 15,000 people who signed a petition organised by the STUC and the culture unions to warn about the irreversible damage that this proposal would have had, which could have put 8,500 jobs totally on the line and at risk. And that is on top of the fact that Scottish Contemporary Art Network members surveyed last year said that a quarter of them have already left the sector or have been forced to seek additional work. And today's crisis, we see, is a result of a decade of standstill funding for culture. And I'm delighted to see the Culture Minister listening to me very intently. Let's just look at it. The funding for our five national performing companies has been £22 million since 2016-17. That is a freeze of investment, and we need more opportunities for our young people, because we've already lost cultural organisations, and the impact of defunding our arts has been felt right across the country. Over the last year, we've lost Edinburgh's Film House, the Belmont in Aberdeen, the Inverness Ironworks, which was a beacon of live music, going to be demolished to make way for a £30 million hotel. And we can already see our arts and culture organisations under huge pressure. And as the Edinburgh Sculpture Watcher said, if we have reductions, it will wreak havoc, but it won't reap significant savings. So that is the challenge, because on top of a decade of cuts to our councils, we have that cost of living crisis and we've rocketing costs. In Edinburgh, our King's Theatre urgently needs investment to make it fit for purpose. It's a national treasure with a huge economic impact, and it's a key part of our cultural offer in our international festival. But the cost of living crisis has pushed up costs. So that means we urgently need funding from every level of government, our city council, the Scottish Government and the UK Government. Culture is who we are. It's critical to our health and well-being, our economy and tourism. And there is so much more that needs to be done to support our councils and our cultural organisations. Daniel Johnson mentioned social prescribing. It's an excellent idea. It works. We know that from the research. But our Health Minister, Hamza Yousaf, told our Culture Committee, you'll have to wait till 2026. That is not good enough. This budget does not address the perfect storm. We need a recovery plan for our arts and culture sector. It's not in this budget, and we need that action now. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Boyack. I now call John Mason to be followed by Ross Greer for around 6 minutes. Mr Mason.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm happy to speak again at this stage of the budget process. I may repeat similar themes to some of my previous speeches, and I'm sure Murdo Fraser will be quick to pick me up if I've said something before. So let's start with the economic backdrop. The IMF has predicted that the UK will be the only major economy to shrink in 2023. Now, we can blame COVID or Brexit or whatever, but clearly we have had a succession of incompetent Westminster governments, both Labour and Conservative, who have failed to keep up with our European neighbours. And I think... Oh, absolutely, yes.
Murdo Fraser.
I'm very grateful to Mr Mason for giving way. If the supposed lack of growth in the UK economy is a sign of incompetence, what does he put down to the fact that the Scottish economy has, since 2014, grown at only one half of the UK average rate? Who is responsible for that, Mr Mason?
John Mason.
But I would still say it was Westminster's responsible primarily for the economy. And in fact, Scotland compares with most of the UK very favourably, apart from the southeast of England. But I was actually going to move on to Labour now, and I think it's worth reminding ourselves how Labour approach budgets, not least at Glasgow City Council last week. apparently with the endorsement of their alleged national leadership. Glasgow was setting its budget in incredibly difficult times, and of course we all agree that we would like our local councils to have more resources for use for the great needs that they face. But for the Labour councillors to not even attend the budget meeting strikes me as totally irresponsible. I led the opposition in Glasgow for some years, albeit a fairly small group with Mr Gibson's mother. However, we always sought to take part in the budget process and come up with some suggestions as to how the administration's budget could be improved. Very briefly.
Kenneth Gibson.
Can Mr Mason explain the difference between Mr Sweeney talking to an empty George Square and a few Labour councillors and what happened in Tony Blair's first budget when Labour cut 9% off the city budget, £97 million in a single year, and some 3,000 workers were sacked and thousands more were in George Square, being spoken to by myself, I have to say, through a megaphone, and Labour councillors had to be smuggled out the back door. So there is a difference, is there not?
John Mason.
I do thank him for that intervention. I think he's made his point. To go back to my speech, even when I was in leading the opposition in Glasgow City Council, sometimes we had just made a few extra admin savings in order to provide some more for frontline services. But we did make an attempt to make the then Labour budget a bit better. But effectively, what happened in Glasgow last week was that the Labour councillors could not come up with even one improvement to the SNP budget. So actually, I think we should take that as a compliment to the SNP administration in Glasgow, that despite the difficult challenges they face, Labour effectively endorsed the budget. Both the Scottish Government and Parliament and our local councils have to produce balanced budgets. None of us likes the budgets we are having to set, and we would all like to spend more both nationally and locally on education, health, arts, culture and so on. I think I've probably taken enough, unless I'm going to get a lot of extra time.
I can give you the time back.
Okay, right.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the member whether he thinks that Labour councillors should have stayed to hear cuts to social care, whether they should have stayed to hear cuts to burying dead people, whether they should have stayed to hear cuts to education, cuts to psychological services, cuts to the museums, and cuts to swimming pools and closures? Or should we have gone out and stood with the people of Glasgow?
John Mason.
I think if they thought the SNP administration could have done anything better, they should have suggested that. And it was because they couldn't think of anything better, other than saying money should come out the air, that they left. And I just see that as totally irresponsible and undemocratic and anything else you want to call it. But the reality is we do not have the resources we would like, and we do have to live within our means. If Labour MSPs would like to copy their Glasgow councillor colleagues and leave the chamber at this point during my speech, I will not take it personally. But I would just warn them that they look just as irresponsible as their colleagues did in the state chambers last week. Now, moving on to some of the more specific parts of the budget, I very much welcome the slight increases in income tax for those who can afford it. And let's be realistic, while some people in our society are really struggling, others are doing very well and have ample money to spend. For example, a new restaurant just opened in my constituency at the turn of the year, but it is solidly booked at key times, and I still haven't managed to get a meal there. So some people in our society are clearly comfortably off and can afford to pay a little more in tax, and that means we can use the extra money for those in greater need. It is reckoned that Scotland would have £1 billion less in revenue if we were to match income tax rates in the rest of the UK. The Conservatives seem to favour that approach, but so far they have failed to say where they would cut that extra revenue. Would it be from the health services or from local government or wherever? The Conservatives also argue we need to be competitive with the rest of the UK, and of course we do need to be competitive. But that does not just mean the amount of tax we pay. It also means a host of other things. People choose to live and work in particular places for a host of reasons, including to be near family and friends, where there is reasonably priced housing, where there are good quality schools, colleges and universities, where there is a good health service, where the environment is cleaner, and I would suggest also where they have a government that at least tries to make life fairer and better for ordinary people. On the expenditure side, as has been said, we need to make choices. Of course, we would all like to spend more money in the NHS, more in primary health care, preventative measures, more in local government, colleges, house building, public transport. But if the money is not there and cannot be raised in the short term, then we do have to live within our means. I agree that in the longer term we need to look at replacing council tax and potentially introducing some new taxes to fund public services, but that is not going to happen in the next 6 weeks before we start the new year. Nor, for that matter, is the fiscal framework likely to improve in the near future. It still seems to me that the system is fixed against us, and it is incredibly difficult for us to compete with London and the South East of England. And I wish the new First Minister, Deputy First Minister and Finance Secretary, whoever they may be, well in negotiating all of that with Westminster. I do welcome the £100 million for extra for local government, £6.6 million for arts and culture, and I'm pleased to support this budget and would urge all members to vote for it at decision time. I am pleasantly surprised that Labour members are still here, although I accept they could walk out at any moment. So I would urge members to support the budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Mason. I now call Ross Greer to be followed by James Dorn in around 6 minutes. Mr Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The relatively compressed nature of the way we do budget processes these days puts those of us involved in the situation of having three very similar debates in very short order, stage one and three in the rates resolution, four if you count the local government settlement. The context for this year's budget is just as we've discussed previously. It's by far the most difficult in this Parliament and government's history. But this afternoon's update from the Deputy First Minister is a very welcome one, and probably to the relief of journalists assigned to covering this afternoon's debate, it gives us some fresh points for discussion. I know that the additional £100 million for local government will be warmly welcomed, particularly if it's used as intended to support pay. Although I have had inquiries from some of my own party's councillors this afternoon that I would appreciate if the government could respond to later on, just asking on a practical level when the new local government circular will be circulated, because some councils are setting budgets today, tomorrow, and over the course of the coming week. Councils are under immense pressure at the moment. I wouldn't pretend that this settlement solves all the challenges that they face. This budget gives councils a significant cash terms funding increase, but we're all familiar with the impact of inflation on public sector pay, the spike in energy and food prices, the growing demand for services like social care, and the myriad of other challenges that local government faces. The Scottish Government faces those same challenges, and without the full fiscal and economic powers needed to handle them. One long overdue solution to that problem, though it certainly wouldn't resolve all of the challenges in and of itself, is the replacement of the council tax. It's mad that the primary lever of local taxation in Scotland is largely set nationally and that it's based on valuations from before I was born. Most people pay the wrong rate of council tax because those valuations are so tragically out of date. Four out of the five parties in this Parliament have at various points in the last few years published proposals for a council tax replacement, some based on income and others on land and property values. By the midpoint of the last session of this Parliament, we were closer than we'd ever been before to agreeing on a replacement before that process was derailed by the pandemic. A new process is now underway, co-chaired by one Green and one SNP minister and by a representative of COSLA. And I was genuinely pleased to hear Daniel Johnson's comments at stage one of the budget process that Labour are prepared to re-engage with that question. Agreeing a replacement for the council tax could be one of the key achievements of this session of Parliament. I'm confident that the process we've established through the Bute House Agreement will lead to that replacement being developed and agreed between the parties of government, but I know that it would be stronger for the engagement of the opposition. So I hope that Liberal and Conservative colleagues will join Labour and put forward their proposals. I'm sure that Mr Arthur and Mr Harvey would welcome the contributions of any new ideas to the discussion. One other point from earlier debates that I'd like to pick up on was made by Liz Smith, and it was around labour market participation, because it's a point that I think we can all agree on. We have increasing evidence now, particularly from a study by Sheffield Hallam University, that there's a significant number of people on incapacity benefit in Scotland who do want to work. And I would emphasise the distinction there. There are a number of people on incapacity benefit and who are unable to work, and this is not about pushing them into work that they're unable to do. But there's now significant evidence of a number of people on incapacity benefit because they can't find a form of work that meets their specific needs. And it's for that reason that I welcome the increase in funding for employability programmes in this budget, particularly for employability programmes for parents looking to re-enter the workforce. And I think that goes back to the point that Michelle Thompson made as well around the gendered impact of inequality in labour market participation. Increasing the parental employability fund was something that Greens had worked hard for during the budget process, so I'm glad to see it here. Despite the challenges out with our control, this is the greenest budget ever, Scrapping peak time rail fares will save travellers hundreds of pounds, and NBOT ASLA, if correctly labelled, a tax on commuters. 20,000 more children will be eligible for free school meals. £80 million will be invested in expanding school catering facilities so that eligibility can be expanded to even more children as soon as possible. There's over £2 billion to tackle the climate and nature crises. That includes increased funding for nature restoration, for our national parks and for environment agencies. The £25 a week game-changing Scottish child payment will be fully rolled out. As the IFS have confirmed, Scotland will have the most progressive tax and social security system anywhere in the UK. By raising the higher rate of income tax and the additional dwelling supplement, the highest earners and those buying holiday homes and extra properties will pay a bit more to fund the public services which are so desperately needed during this cost of living crisis. Scotland has extremely limited devolved taxation and revenue-raising powers, and whilst we certainly need more financial powers, it would be wrong to just make that argument without making best use of the powers that we do have. Because we might be in a cost of living crisis, but there are plenty of high-income and wealthy people in this country who can afford to pay a bit more. Those on the highest incomes can afford an extra penny on the tax paid on the top slice of their salary, and those in a position where they can buy a second home or a holiday home can absolutely afford to pay a bit more on that purchase. So I'm proud that this budget will see the higher and top rates of income tax and the additional dwelling supplement on LBTT rise. Between these rate changes and freezing income tax thresholds, more than £500 million more will be raised to support public services and to deliver those vital additional interventions like free school meal expansion. And that's building on the progress that we already made in 2018, making income tax and council tax that bit more progressive. Despite the challenges, this budget delivers for people and planet. It includes a record £2.2 billion to tackle the climate emergency. It delivers more affordable public transport. It provides essential support to children and families, and it does so by having the wealthiest in our society pay a bit more. That is something worth voting for.
Thank you, Mr. Greer. I now call James Dornan to be followed by Miles Briggs, around 6 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As you'll be aware, this is my foray back to the Parliament as part of my phased return to work. So I'd like to start off by thanking those from all corners of the Chamber who contacted me to wish me well. It does go to show that underneath the masks of a politician often lies a real human being. Not always, but often. However, much as it's been a while since I've been here for a debate, nothing much appears to have changed. We still have Labour and Tories listing off all the things we should have done, whilst forgetting that in parts of the UK in which they're in power, they haven't bothered to implement them. It'd be nice if, whilst listening to today's debate, we could put aside the party politics. You maybe should disregard the rest of my speech then. Remember who we are and are here to represent, and accepts it's essential to agree in today's budget if we want to deliver that fairer and more prosperous Scotland. Now, I'm the first to admit that this budget is not what I'd like it to be. However, unlike the Labour and Tory parties, I'm still unaware of where that money tree is planted. Just as a reminder to all round the Chamber, Scotland works within a fixed budget. Everything we commit to, we have to have the money to implement. If we want to spend more money in schools, we have to find that money from another service. We can't luxuriate in the fantasy of an uncosted wish list at budget time, and neither should any serious party of opposition. It's already touched on by my fellow ex-councillor, John Mason, but I know how hard it is to get a budget through as an opposition leader. When I was leader of Glasgow SNP, I put one forward that cost me my finance spokesperson and a ton of misery from some within my group. Some because I hadn't included a pet project, or some because I wasn't cutting enough, but I still did it. And that's because we're a serious opposition with ambitions to take on governance of Glasgow. It's just a shame that neither of the main opposition parties had the guts to do that. Listening to some of the opposition speeches today, you miss the importance. You'd forget how essential delivering the budget is to improving the lives of those most in need. Namely, the aim to eradicate child poverty, transform the economy and create sustainable public services. Aims the people of Scotland expect us to agree on. And let's not forget that according to the IMF, under the Tories' watch, Britain will be the only G7 economy to shrink in 2023, making life harder for millions. And remember, when looking at today's proposals, these are proposals that will see social security spending increase to more than £5.1 billion per year, proposals which will continue the most ambitious child poverty reduction measure in the UK, the Scottish Child Payments, and these are measures which are making a real difference to those facing hardship and poverty. A measure which has risen by over 150% to £25 a week. Benefits will also be uprated by 10.1%, supporting those struggling with the cost of living crisis. According to the OBR, Total spending on Social Security will be more than £770 million above the funding received for Social Security through the block grant adjustment. I've listened to other views on the shortcomings of today's budget, but if they're serious about tackling them, they should support calls for Scotland to have full control over its finances. Anything else simply shows them up to be simply parties too beholden to the Union to put the needs of the people of Scotland first. And finally, Presiding Officer, it's important to remember that today's budget continues and maintains a number of commitments that we are rightly proud of. Free higher education, free bus travel. Last week we heard that patients in England are failing to collect prescriptions or, heartbreakingly, asking pharmacists which ones they can do without because they cannot afford prescription charges, which stand at a staggering £9.35 per item. Let's not forget, in Scotland, prescriptions are free, and that today's budget continues this policy. And only the other day, London's mayor announced that it would provide free school meals for a year, describing them as game-changing plans. Now, I welcome that announcement, but also, let's not forget, that rather than game-changing, this is a norm in Scotland, and not only for the year. I realise my speech is shorter than usual. I obviously have lost my time in presiding officer, so I apologise for that. So in conclusion, it's time for this Parliament, under threat like it never has been before, to rally behind the needs of the people of Scotland, demand the powers of full control over fiscal powers, and support this budget to ensure that the people of Scotland continue to benefit from the decisions made in this Parliament today. Support the budget, please.
Thank you, Mr Dornan. Welcome back, and clearly time goes most slowly when you're joining us online. I now call Miles Briggs to be followed by Emma Roddick, around 6 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I welcome James Dornan back to Parliament as well? Those of us who serve on the Social Justice Committee get to see him on a weekly basis down the television, so we do welcome him back to Parliament in person. Over the past few hours, we've heard a new word, probably in politics, and that is de-endorsement. Of many of the SNP members' decisions around their leadership. But I would like to today welcome the Finance Secretary's de-endorsement of many parts of his budget. Because I do welcome the fact that he has listened to many concerns put forward and changed spending commitments within this coming budget as well. In recent weeks, I've met with councillors across Scotland from all parties and listened to their concerns. And I want to open today by thanking all of those who work in local government across our country, because they have gone the extra mile during the pandemic to help support all our communities and still feel that they have not been given the support that they need to carry on and recover from that pandemic. Because for many in local government, it feels like the challenges and pressures on local services have not passed or recovered, that they are very real today. And after 15 years of this SNP government underfunding local government in Scotland, there are increasing concerns over the long-term financial sustainability of our local government finances and the problems which face our councils across the country. Absolutely. Put simply, though, for council leaders I've spoken to across Scotland, there is nothing more that they can cut beyond core services to balance their budgets. Now, they will welcome this additional £1 million. Many will start balancing that with the funding floor, which will probably see the Finance Minister give with one hand and take away with the other. But despite this, councils will be setting their budgets in the coming weeks and will still have to make significant cuts to services. In Clackmannanshire, councillors are considering reducing home-to-school transport and the amount of money spent on the delivery of secondary school subjects. In Kenny Gibson's own area of North Ayrshire, the Arran Outdoor Education Centre could be shut to save cash. Beyond education, leisure services will face cuts in many areas. Inverclyde Council is looking to close Greenock Sports Centre, Port Glasgow Swimming Pool. In West Lothian Council, in my own region, library services are suggested for cuts, including West Calder. And in Western Bartonshire, the council is thinking about reducing opening hours for recycling centres. Many charities are worried about the loss of grant funding from local authorities as well. That is concerning so many of our third sector, who feel they could be the last in the line to receive vital funding for the services that they deliver. And like most councils, Aberdeen City and Western Bartonshire are looking at putting up many charges as well. In East Ayrshire, they're now looking at a 4% increase in rent charges for temporary accommodation as well. And in East Renfrewshire, there's already a 40% charge on top of council tax for households
who want additional garden waste removed, this will go up to £60. Now, we need to look towards, and I listened to the Finance Secretary say a better deal to work with councils and work with council leaders. I really think we need to move towards that, because this last budget has seen so many imaginative ways councils are looking at changing their funding, at looking at how they can repurpose council debt, especially around PPP schemes. I don't see anything else they can do in the future which the Scottish Government does not need to help them support to balance budgets. Yes,
I will be First Minister.
I'm grateful to Mr Briggs for giving way and for his recognition of the substance of the point that I'm making about the need for a more collaborative arrangement. And what, you know, I made that proposition in the budget statement in December, and I followed it up with dialogue with council leaders, and I put on record my willingness and the government's willingness to engage in that proposition to ensure that we get to a position where we meet these financial challenges by having a more collaborative approach to how we address these issues.
Miles Briggs.
And I welcome that, but I do think we need to formally embed that partnership between Scottish Government and local authorities as well, because the Barnett formula ensures the Scottish Government budget is linked to UK Government spending, and they have bailed out the Deputy First Minister to the tune of £146 million, I believe, of additional spend now available. But our councils are not necessarily seeing that same uplift in their budgets, and we need to see, actually, I believe, that vital opportunity for what we are asking our councils to fund, and more policy funding commitments, is properly funded, not just for 1 year, but how they take these policies forward. That is something the Local Government Committee hears again and again, that local councils cannot then match the policy delivery because they're not having the resources forthcoming. One of the key issues I raised during stage one debate, and Sarah Boyack touched upon a lot of this as well, is with regards to the housing crisis and also the cut to the housing budget. And I think that is something we do need to reflect on. And it is not just Labour politicians or Conservative politicians warning against this. Shelter were outside Parliament today outlining just their concern. We have the record levels of people living in temporary accommodation. If I can get the time back, I will.
Accepting an intervention. And first of all, the large outdoor education centre will be saved. But do you not see that there's a direct correlation between the United Kingdom government cutting Scotland's capital allocation by £500 million this year and £185 million next year, and a reduced inability at a time of high inflation to build more houses?
Miles Briggs.
Well, there's a number of competing factors. I take the member's point on that, but I'm not going to apologise for the fact that we are in a housing crisis, that we have the highest number of children and pregnant women living in temporary accommodation. Yep. Here in the capital, we are seeing levels of homelessness we have never experienced before, and the response from this SNP Green government is to cut 16% from the housing budget and underfund Edinburgh City Council and our health board as well. So delivering outcomes, I think ministers need to really consider what they're not doing for Edinburgh. And so I make no apologies for raising that in Parliament today, because decisions taken to cut affordable housing supply programmes at the very time we're seeing these increases will come back to haunt this government. And I think in the autumn we will see a housing crisis in Scotland and the potential collapse of the housing market here in Edinburgh, and SNP and Green members will be held responsible for that. Presiding officer, it is critical that we now move towards how local authorities can meet these cuts and what impact it will have on our communities, and we will be hearing that in the coming days. But it is clear from this budget, this SNP Green budget, is a pay more, get less budget. I don't think that's something we can endorse. And as my colleague Liz Smith says, after 15 years of this SNP government, it is clear that ministers have no fresh ideas to help grow the Scottish economy. And ultimately, it is Scottish taxpayers who are paying the price for this failure to stimulate our Scottish economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. I now call Emma Roddick to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Around 6 minutes, Ms Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Governing leadership is about choices. Who and what you prioritise, the principles that you stand by, and the choices that you make about where to place limited money and resources. I am proud to be in a party which unashamedly and consistently prioritises tackling poverty, tackling climate change, and tackling social inequalities. I led a debate just before recess on Financial Times analysis into the unacceptable level of income inequality in the UK. Instead of the UK government tackling this massive gap between the richest and poorest, it is instead ensuring, by design, that it gets bigger. In this budget, we are actually tackling the cost of living crisis, and particularly child poverty, with targeted benefits unique in the UK and a progressive taxation policy that will redistribute wealth. £428 million in social security, including uprating of devolved benefits, supplements to reserve benefits, and measures like the Scottish Child Payment, which are unique in the UK. That is money going directly to those who need it, to tackle poverty, particularly child poverty, and, of course, in terms of supporting the economy, money that is going to people who will spend it, not just store it away. New benefits and top-ups to UK-wide benefits mean that by April, the poorest tenth of Scottish households are set to have incomes £580 per year higher than they would under the system in place in England and Wales. Amongst the poorest 30%, Scottish reforms are set to raise the incomes of households with children by around £2,000 a year on average. And this is a good budget for the Highlands and Islands too. In addition to benefiting from the national policies I've just outlined, I know that many of my constituents will strongly welcome the news that the Scottish Government intends to take action on funding inter-island ferries. The increased cost of fuel, amongst other pressures, is really testing the budgets of local authorities in my region, who I'm sure will appreciate this support. Yes, I will.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Emma Roddick for giving way, and I echo her praise to the Government for funding inter-island ferries and their uplift that they require. But does she agree with me that we are sustaining an ageing ferry fleet? And actually, particularly in the Shetland Isles, it's time we started talking about funding fixed links, short tunnels, to connect those islands.
Emma Roddick.
Yeah, absolutely, and I'm looking forward to the new Islands Connectivity Plan, which will look at fixed links as well as ferries only. And I also hope that this change is going to open the door to ministers reconsidering extending under 22 free bus travel to inter-island ferries to put our young islanders, particularly those who live in outer islands, on an even footing with mainlanders. I also want to welcome the announcement about Creative Scotland's funding, because I've got a very cheery Claire Adamson sitting next to me. And I understand the initial decision to expect the organisation to make use of its reserves rather than continue to top them up. But it's very exciting to now think of what its funded organisations will be able to do with both this continued extra funding as well as its reserves. My region is incredibly rich in arts and culture, and I look forward to seeing what Eden Court and creatives across the Highlands and Islands will do with the financial and confidence boost that the Deputy First Minister has given them today. But I do know that the Scottish Government would like to go further and that it is unable to because of the constraints of devolution. And I do think that maybe mitigating successfully so many of the worst UK policies over and over has given people an inaccurate sense of how possible and easy it is to do alongside governing to the best of our ability on devolved matters. So much of our limited budget is going towards protecting people from another government's welfare cuts. That is unsustainable and it's just plain wrong. We need the powers here to tackle the problem at source, and I am disappointed, though not surprised, to hear opposition members call for more public spending with no suggestion of what to cut and no support for calls for greater fiscal flexibility. Now, £20 million for a referendum to me would have been incredible value for money, and indeed it's less than the correction of the error that the Deputy First Minister informed us about us earlier. And I've said this before, but it is incredible when you think about it, so I'm going to repeat it. We expect to spend £770 million this year on mitigating UK government decisions like the bedroom tax. That's 38 referendums. But as the UK government has refused against democratic sense to allow to ask the people of Scotland if they've changed their minds, I can think of no better use for that money than to extend the fuel insecurity fund. That is vital for the Highlands and Islands, where people are being left to suffer fuel poverty as a direct result of Whitehall's failure to regulate the energy market and address unfairness in the system, like that which sees my constituents face higher standing charges than people elsewhere in the UK. We also know now more than ever that volatility in the market and interest rates is not the only challenge that we face. We heard in the Deputy First Minister's opening speech that an error in the spending review meant we're working to different figures than the last time we discussed the budget. And last year, I and every other SNP MSP was asked on multiple occasions to welcome increases to the budget and then later comment on the fact that those increases were no longer happening. I don't envy the Deputy First Minister his role in trying to deal with the ever-changing promises of the size of our budget, and I hope that the people of Scotland will see how ridiculous it is that we can't overspend, borrow, react to events within a fiscal year, but are expected to deal with someone else doing those things and the impact that that has on our spending decisions. The Scottish Government, in conclusion, in setting this budget, has also set an intention of the kind of country that we want to be. Fairer, greener, stronger. And I hope very soon we won't just have to imagine what we could do if we also had power over energy policy, immigration, income-based benefits and the economy too. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Rowlett. I now call Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Siobhan Brown, around 6 minutes. Ms. Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Once again, we come to this chamber today to discuss a budget that we on these benches know is failing our communities, and a budget that, I'm afraid to say, illustrates either an inability or an unwillingness to protect those who need it the most. It's a budget that the SNP Green Government have engineered against a backdrop of hundreds of thousands of Scots struggling to put food on the table, parents going hungry so their children don't have to, households turning their heating off so they can afford to eat, and in some cases being unable to afford to do either. We face the worst cost of living crisis in memory. Prices are rising, but wages aren't. Businesses are closing because running costs are so high, and people are losing their jobs. And money advisers are going home with the same worries they've been advising clients on. This budget should have defended Scottish people against deepening inequality and tackling the scourge of poverty that exists. That should be reducing pressure on families, making work pay, and empowering local councils to take decisions that protect their communities. Instead, the SNP Green budget does none of that. And what they have brought before us today is a budget that is not serious about addressing inequality. Presiding Officer, we all know the saying, don't tell me what you value. Show me your budget and I'll tell you what you value. By that measure, and from looking across the budget where equality scarcely feature, it certainly is clear what this government doesn't value. A budget that was serious about addressing inequality would have addressed women's poverty by valuing women's work, by ending the scandal of poverty pay in the female-dominated social care sector, and by boosting social care wages to £12 an hour immediately. That's what Scottish Labour would have done, because we value our social care workers and we know that they deserve more than a measly lower-than-inflation pay rise that translates to just 40 pence in real terms. We know that unpaid carers deserve more too. A government serious about tackling women's inequality should be prioritising reducing the number of unpaid carers living in poverty, a number currently at 44%. Instead, it's a budget that's bereft of measures to reduce that number, failing to double the carers' allowance supplement despite the government's own commitment, cutting local authority budgets, threatening respite services and failing to target any cost of living support, all while the government continues to leave carers' allowance in the hands of the DWP rather than using the powers of devolution to make a difference to unpaid carers and women's lives. This is a budget that has nothing to offer disabled people either. No targeted support to defend themselves against the rising cost of living, and a failure to use the rollout of the new adult disability payment to ensure social security payments actually reflect the additional costs disabled people face, or to make sure people with fluctuating conditions like MS don't miss out on the money they deserve because of unfair measures still in there, like the 20-metre and the 50% rules. Presiding Officer, a government serious about tackling inequality wouldn't present spending plans that don't even acknowledge Scotland's personal debt crisis. Things are so bad that people are no longer just borrowing for luxuries. They now have no option but to borrow to cover essentials. The situation is dire. Debt causes financial instability, homelessness and mental health issues. It leaves people stressed, drained and overwhelmed. It's not morally or economically sensible for the state to aggressively pursue public debt, which a lot of it is, or to cost itself money as a result of the way it is doing that, especially when we know that most of that debt is never recovered. But there's not a single measure to look to address this in this budget. We should help people get out of debt and stay out of it, not make things worse, and public debt enforcement should never push people into hardship. The need for money and debt advice has never been more important, but the sector is currently oversubscribed and under-resourced. Waiting lists are growing and lifeline services are threatened. The SNP government is willing to let these lifelines go to the wall and inequality deepen as a result, and their budget shows it. It's not just money and debt advice that they're starving of cash. Cuts to public bodies, local government and the third sector will all exacerbate poverty and inequality too. In Glasgow, I've been campaigning on making our city safer for women. A cornerstone of doing that is ensuring reliable, affordable and safe transport options are available. But failing to properly support bus travel means organisations like SPT are having to find millions to plug gaps that they've already warned they can't keep doing. And without further support from the government, they will not be able to defend against service cuts, and it is women who will suffer. Councillors across the country are being forced to make heartbreaking decisions about which vital services to cut, like in Glasgow, where the removal of funding for the food train has left pensioners across the city fearing because they don't know how they'll access food, where education staff and educational psychologists are being cut, threatening not just jobs but our children's education. And community groups like Partick Thistle Community Trust are scrambling to replace funding to keep their programmes running. Where childcare charges are increasing for already struggling families, libraries and sports facilities are reducing opening hours or simply not reopening their doors, and previously funded public museums free are introducing now entry fees. Could I get my time back, Presiding Officer? Thank you. I'll take the intervention.
I thank the member for taking this intervention. She represents a city like I do, who's seen some of the highest increases in homelessness in recent months. What impact do you think this will also have?
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the member for that intervention. I'm terrified about the impact of this budget on homelessness, because we've seen what happens when cuts to local authorities mean they can't meet the homelessness targets, or they can't put people in homes, and the number of children in temporary accommodation in Glasgow is growing. So I'm terrified about what this budget means for homeless people across the city of Glasgow and across other cities in the country. Presiding Officer, the budget before us doesn't just fail to address inequality at central government or tie the hands of councillors to act within local authorities. It's a budget that is slowly eroding a last line of defence people have against inequality too. Last year, the third sector saw more than £1 million cuts to its budget. This year, the Scottish Government is upping its demands on the sector, but not increasing its resources accordingly. The SNP are waxing lyrical on fair pay, but handing responsibility to the third sector without the money and leaving them to pick up the bill. The sector stepped up during the pandemic, and it's doing so again. A budget that doesn't recognise that threatens lifeline services and damages the ability of the sector to provide a safety net. It is crystal clear that this budget is not serious about addressing inequality, and none of this is helped by the fact that the government don't actually have the necessary data to assess the impact the budget decisions actually have. This means neither Audit Scotland or equalities organisations could tell us where spending is helping priority groups. The Equalities Budget Action Group said it's difficult to follow the money through the budget. They say allocations are repeated, the origin of budget line spending is unclear, the narrative doesn't align with the tables it talks about, and this all makes it harder to assess whether spending has gone up or down. It feels like the government can't possibly know whether or not its spending is making a difference to equality. Even navigating the budget was like an artwork in itself, according to one witness in the Equalities Committee. In summary, this is a legacy of entrenched inequality, with minority groups scrapping for crumbs and getting bills instead. That's a legacy the First Minister, of course, will leave behind, but it's one that I suspect her successor may indeed vote for. Enough is enough. Delivering the change Scotland needs starts with getting serious about tackling poverty and inequality, and it's clear that neither the SNP or, I'm afraid to say, the Greens at this point have done so as their priority. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Duncan-Glancy. I now call Siobhan Brown to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Ms Brown.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As we're all fully aware, this has been one of the most challenging budgets under extreme economic pressure. And although very difficult decisions have had to be made, I'm pleased to support today's budget. And I also welcome the additional $100 million for local authorities. And alongside many of my constituents who support the Gaiety Theatre and AIR, we'll welcome the announcement of the $6.6 million investment for culture in Scotland through Creative Scotland. And of course, if it was not for the restraints of devolution, we could have gone much further. And it's disappointing, although expected, the UK government's autumn statement failed to address the pressure on devolved budgets to help people with the cost of living crisis, support public services, and finance fair pay offers. To add to the challenge of our pandemic recovery, we find ourselves in one of the most turbulent economic and political times most of us can ever remember. While Putin continues his barbaric attack on Ukraine, energy prices continue to soar, crippling households and businesses. Inflation continues to rise, adding to everyday household bills, workforce shortages across every sector as a result of Brexit, and of course the infamous mismanagement of the public finances of the UK Conservative government. This Scottish Government continues to do all it can with the powers it has to deliver for the people of Scotland. Because we are in these volatile times, it is critical that the budget is correct to tackle poverty, to protect our NHS and to make us a fairer and greener society. And let me go on to highlight some of the key ways this budget addresses the problems we are facing as a result of the current crisis after Brexit and the pandemic. I'll start with our young people. We know our people are... The pandemic has hit hard on some of our children, and their lives were completely changed by lockdowns and restrictions, and it's imperative that we address the challenges that they're currently facing. With the limited powers it has, the Scottish Government is doing more than any of the UK administration to tackle child poverty, with the expansion of the Scottish Child Payment to under 16s, estimated to take 50,000 children out of poverty, and already increased the groundbreaking payment to £25 per child. This budget invests £428 million to uprate all other devolved benefits in 2023 by September's CPI level of 10.1%. The budget also provides additional support to our education system by ensuring the expansion of free school meals to P6s and P7s in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment. Living in poverty impacts negatively on children's educational outcomes and subjects families to increased stress. And free school meals in our schools promote wellbeing, equity, and food is a key part of the day, and it can make a big difference. And according to Child Poverty Action Group, currently 16% of school children in Scotland who are growing up in poverty are not eligible for free meals. The rollout of P6 to P7 will further reduce this percentage, and it has to be noted 31% of children currently living in England in poverty are not eligible for free school meals. There is a stark difference in political decisions really making a difference. This budget will also deliver for our young people by ensuring their parents and guardians are supported through the cost of living crisis. And I'm sure, as all of MSPs across the chamber will relate to the emails my office has received, contacted by constituents who are worried about turning on their heating over the winter, and heartbreakingly people having to make the choice between heating and eating. This is a reality, and this should not be happening in a developed country in 2023. And all this is happening as energy companies announce record profits, which I personally find absolutely obscene, and the use of food banks continue to grow across the UK, and the current UK Conservative government has failed to take decisive action and deliver for households who are really struggling to get by. The Scottish Government, on the other hand, is the voice of the hardworking people whose monthly income has been eaten away by the rising bills causing many families real hardship. The budget commits £20 million to extend the Fuel Insecurity Fund to provide a lifeline to households, including the most vulnerable, against rising energy prices. We are choosing to take a different path from the austerity-obsessed Tories, using a fair tax system which sees the majority of Scots pay less than if they lived elsewhere in the UK, and to invest in our public services. And let me speak about those public services. We all know that they are under considerable strain, and one of the biggest problems is the damage caused by Brexit to the labour market. So many of our vital services just do not have the staff numbers that they need. And with powers over our own immigration, which has already been... Yes?
Stephen Kerr.
She acknowledged that there are now more EU citizens living in Scotland than there were before 2016. At any point, there's a record level of EU citizens living in Scotland. Would you just acknowledge that?
Siobhan Brown.
Sorry, but I can't acknowledge that because I don't recognise that figure. But I see independent countries that have immigration policies such as Australia and Canada and New Zealand who are trying to get our doctors and nurses to move over there at the moment, and we do not have the powers to do it in Scotland at the moment, so no. Our NHS saw us through COVID. We now have the duty to protect it for future generations, to come to make sure that the quality of your healthcare is not dependent on your income. This budget delivers more than $13.7 billion for our NHS boards, as well as $2 billion to establish and improve primary healthcare services in our communities. Overall, the budget provides record funding of over $19 billion to health and social care portfolio. Sorry, can I get the time back for the intervention?
You can get some time back, please.
Thank you. All of the policies announced in this budget add upon the several benefits that people in other parts of the UK have been unable to take advantage of under the Conservative and Labour governments, including free prescriptions, free higher education, free concessionary bus travel for the under-22s. And I long for the day we can have the powers to go further. Please support today's budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Brown. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Emma Harper. Mr Kerr.
Well, Siobhan Brown, I can assure you that what I shared in my intervention is factual. As it's true for the whole of the United Kingdom, it's true of Scotland. And can I also acknowledge in Siobhan Brown's speech that she used for the first time a very important word that hadn't appeared, I think, in any previous speech, which must be acknowledged, and that is Ukraine. And in this week of all weeks, it is absolutely fundamental that we unitedly acknowledge the impact that Vladimir Putin's aggression in Ukraine is costing not just the people of Ukraine, obviously, in the first instance, but the entirety of Europe and the entirety of the world economy is impacted by what is happening in Ukraine in terms of energy and food security. And that is the backdrop to this budget and to the UK's budget as well. Having said that, I do agree also with something that I heard earlier, which is that budgets do show political priority. And I'd have to say that this budget, whatever it does, shows that the SNP's political priority is not education and skills. It's not about our young people. And take, for example, higher education. This budget represents a real-term cut in funding of 0.7% for our universities. It includes a 2.7% cut in capital investment, and we are in real danger of Scotland's universities falling further behind the rest of the United Kingdom and more dependent on revenue from international students' fees in an increasingly volatile global market. And there has been a 84% increase in the number of Scottish students being refused entry to Scottish universities since the year 2006. And this can't be right. Educating young Scots is not the priority for this government, and it ought to be.
Deputy First Minister.
I wonder if Mr Kerr would care to complete the picture by recognising that there are a record number of young people from Scotland going to university and a record number of young people from deprived backgrounds going to university as well.
Stephen Kerr.
Welcome the fact that we are catching up with the rest of the United Kingdom in relation to accessibility to university from people who come from disadvantaged and difficult backgrounds. The reality is, in tertiary education, the lack of parity that the SNP sees between universities and colleges is writ large in terms of the differential payments they pay for students. Colleges will be forced to make 25% redundancies this year.
Bob Doris.
Very well known, I'm sure, wish to confirm to Parliament that we've both raised the issue of the disparity in funding between colleges and universities at the Education Committee, but we also know that the Scottish Funding Council are doing due diligence work to hopefully address that aspect and bring forward real-life data to hopefully address that funding gap going forward. Is that something you would support?
Stephen Kerr.
I can support the fact that we need to remove the disparity of esteem there is in terms of the choices that young people face, that the road to university should no longer be paved with gold when the other pathways that are available to young people are not available to them with the same degree of commitment and support. And I repeat again, colleges will be forced to make redundancies, and SNP and Green members should be ashamed. The Chamber will also well know that universities receive £7,500 per student, which college students only attract £5,000. Those are the numbers behind. Such is the disparity of esteem. On apprenticeships, the Scottish Training Federation has pointed out repeatedly that the Scottish Government has frozen places. Perhaps someone on the government benches would like to tell me that they are wrong.
Jimmy Hepburn.
I'm happy to. If you don't have the figures in front of me right now, Presiding Officer, but what I can say is the latest set of figures show an uplift and an increase in number of starts at quarter three compared to quarter two. Mr Kerr told me there was a freeze. It seems to be apprentices are still being recruited this year.
Stephen
the Scottish
Kerr.
Training Federation is now being accused by the Minister of not knowing what they're talking about, because they say there is a freeze. They say that training organisations will be forced out of business completely. This SNP, the Deputy First Minister has lost the head.
Could I please ask for a bit
He's lost the head.
Please resume your seat. Could I have less sedentary hurling of abuse, I think, as the previous PO in the chair described it. Mr Kerr, please resume.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The SNP clearly does not see further higher or technical education as a priority. It ought to be. Governments commit resources based on their priorities. I will give way. I'm conscious of the fact I may be running out of time, though.
A wee bit extra time will be given back, Mr Kerr.
Right.
Monica Lennon.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way. I think some very important points have been made about the future of apprenticeships. And I know that the Minister pays a lot of attention to the cross-party group in construction, but there were very serious concerns raised just the week before recess about the future of plumbers, electricians, other trade, decorating and so on. And concerns were raised that some of those apprenticeships might end and people might not get jobs. So these are important points. Perhaps the Minister who's listening would engage with the group urgently because there are genuine concerns out there.
Mr Kerr.
Glad to facilitate Monica Lennon making a plea to the Minister. By the way, I endorse what Monica Lennon has said. Combined with the cuts in colleges and the cuts in Skills Development Scotland, this is not the direction that we should be travelling in this country at the minute, given the economic backdrop that we are all dealing with. And whatever John Swinney says, usually at length and at the top of his voice, as witnessed earlier, especially when he's speaking to me, this SNP government does not prioritise the future of our young people. Yeah. They don't put their money where their mouth is. And, Presiding Officer, it looks like it will be no fun growing up in SNP Scotland over the next few years, because we know there is a real shortfall in council spending and that young people will bear the brunt of these cuts in their communities. If anyone on the government benches is going to stand up and tell me that this local government settlement is good and generous and will help make their communities the best places for our children to grow up in, I'm delighted to hear from them. And the Deputy First Minister on cue stands.
Briefly, Deputy First Minister.
I'm very grateful for the opportunity to say to Mr Kerr and to the Chamber that a local government settlement that gives local government £793 million more than they were expecting is undoubtedly a very good deal for local government in the financial chaos inflicted on us by the Conservative government.
Yeah. Oh, dear. Kerr. Oh, dear. Oh, dear. It's the same old broken record. So, Deputy First Minister, where are the additional 3,500 teachers, additional 3,500 teachers promised in the SNP manifesto? There are actually fewer teachers this year than there were last year. Where's the additional 3,500? Even with the threats of sanctions looming over local councils, the fact is the actual number of teachers is falling. And as we heard yesterday from the University of Stirling, subject choice is narrowing, impacting negatively on the life chances of our young people. Councils have been forced to make other cuts because of the threats that have been issued by Shirley Ann Somerville. And what's the impact of this? If I may indulge the chair for one moment longer. Falkirk Council's SNP administration have proposed cuts to school transport that will affect 600 children who have to walk busy roads for miles and miles without transport. And this is the same SNP administration that is closing 4 swimming pools. Meanwhile, councils of all political persuasions and sizes are looking at a host of savings and cuts that will impact on young people.
Mr Kerr, could I please ask you to conclude?
I will conclude.
Pretty generous.
Cuts to, I appreciate that. Cuts to youth services, summer play opportunities, swimming lessons, yeah, cheaper ways of making school meals, cuts to social interventions. Scotland, thanks to the SNP cuts to local authorities, become a land of rusting play equipment, yeah, closed community centres and cancelled futures. And it isn't good enough.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr Kerr. And I now call Emma Harper, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So, to govern is to choose, and the Scottish Government has made its choice, and Emma Roddick stated that very well. Eradicating child poverty, transforming the economy to deliver net zero, and creating sustainable public services are the key aims of the Scottish Budget this year. Families, businesses and our public finances are under sustained economic pressure, and the Scottish Government has acted decisively to provide what support it can within the resources that we have allocated. Steps the Government take now will help ensure Scotland emerges from the current crisis a stronger, fairer, greener and more equal country. And I welcome that James Dornan described that in his contribution, and I welcome his return to Chamber today also. So, of course, the Scottish Government would like to go even further, but the cost of living crisis has laid bare the fiscal constraints of devolution and the need for Scotland to take its place as a normal independent nation. Presiding Officer, with the current fiscal powers, the Scottish Government is enacting, right through this budget, more than any other UK administration to tackle poverty. Scotland is the only part of the UK to introduce the Scottish Child Payment, which has now been increased to £25, so it's a 150% increase in 8 months. The budget extends this to all under-16s, which is estimated to lift 50,000 children out of poverty here in Scotland. The Joseph Rowntree Foundation said the full rollout of the Scottish Child Payment is a watershed moment for tackling poverty in Scotland, and the rest of the UK should take notice. Indeed, a recent report from Child Poverty Action Group shows the cost of bringing up a child in Scotland is significantly reduced thanks to Scottish Government interventions. Including the Scottish Child Payment, alongside free school meals, Best Start grant payments and free bus travel as well. However, this progress is undermined by the actions of the UK Government, with the same report stating that Scottish policies are immensely important in reducing the level of financial strain and hardship on families, but they are fighting a rearguard action. Fighting a rearguard action, Presiding Officer. Difficult decisions are required, and this budget ensures resources are targeted where they are most needed and can secure maximum value for every pound spent. However, the choices faced are all starker because of the UK Government. Economic projections show the staggering cost of continued Westminster control. The IMF, as Deputy First Minister has rightly mentioned, has recently predicted that the UK will be the only major economy to shrink in 2023. This is a devastating indictment on the UK Government's management of the economy and will only further exacerbate the significant challenges faced by the Scottish Government. The UK Government's disastrous approach to Brexit has damaged labour supply through the loss of free movement of people and undermined frictionless trade with our nearest markets. Presiding Officer, at no stage since the reconvening of the Scottish Parliament in 1999 have conditions been more volatile and the dangers more severe. In autumn, the Scottish Government had to make unprecedented reductions to its spending plans midway through the current financial year, totalling £1.2 billion. The Scottish Government had to do this because once a financial year commences, and in the absence of borrowing powers to address in-year volatility or the ability to alter income tax, it operates a fixed total budget unless the UK Government allocates any additional money to Scotland. And for the first time since this government took power, the Finance Secretary has announced a budget for the next financial year, assuming that the Scottish Government does not carry forward any fiscal resources from this year to next. So for comparison, the Scottish Government for this year was underpinned by £450 million of resources carried over from the previous year. But the absence of that carryover increases the financial challenges that the government faces. And Presiding Officer, on the National Care Service, I'm not sure where Douglas Lumsden was sitting in the committee room when we took evidence at Health and Sport Committee from the many people who do actually support a National Care Service, especially the people with lived experience who want their care to be more joined up and more about what they choose as well. So I'm just wondering if Douglas Lumsden wants to ignore and disregard the voices of lived experience when we're trying to take evidence at committee. So, of course I will.
Douglas Lumsden.
I guess it's not so much about what the people with care experience. Well, obviously, there needs to be changes, but at this point, the government can't even tell us what that is and how much it's going to cost. We've had a financial memorandum, came to the finance department, the finance committee, I mean, and was completely inadequate and had to be thrown out. That is what we're calling for, is actual clarity of what the National Care Service is going to be.
Emma Harper.
So am I hearing that Douglas Lumsden is actually in favour of a national care service now? Because the framework legislation is in process. We haven't even got our first report from Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. So maybe if members were a wee bit more patient and got on board, included with the lived experience of the folk that are saying that we should take this national care service forward, maybe the members should actually maybe look at the evidence instead of reading what they see in the papers. So, Presiding Officer, one final point I'd like to briefly touch on is local authority funding. Councils and their employees play a crucial role in our communities across Scotland and deserve the fairest settlement possible. And in the most challenging budget settlement since devolution, the Scottish Government is providing nearly £13.5 billion in local government settlement this year. And just looking at the notes of what the Deputy First Minister has said earlier, just remind Chamber that the additional funding for 2022-24 is on top of the £570 million increase in funding that has already been included in the local government settlement, and the total additional funding for next year for local government is £793 million. So I'm conscious of time, Presiding Officer, so in conclusion, I support this budget. I will vote for the budget at decision time, and I will encourage my colleagues across Chamber to support this budget at decision time too. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. And we will now move to closing speeches, and I call on Jackie Bailey to wind up for Scottish Labour. Around 7 minutes, please, Ms Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Let me start on a note of consensus and welcome the additional money for Creative Scotland and, of course, for teachers' pay. This budget will shape the next SNP leader's priorities in government. Nicola Sturgeon's replacement has a choice to make: vote against this budget or continue her legacy of cutting local government, slashing public services and continuing the crisis in health and social care. Perhaps this is wishful thinking on my part. After all, many of the candidates have been sat around the cabinet table agreeing to successive cuts to local government for years now. Kate Forbes has been the cabinet secretary for finance and the economy for 3 years. And on her watch, council budgets have been hit year after year. She had an opportunity to transform the wages of social care workers, but failed to do so. Hamza Youssef, as cabinet secretary for health and social care, should have spoken up for social care staff and services years ago, but instead he voted for the budgets that have crippled them, and he looks set to do the same again today. And Ash Reagan has voted for every single council cutting budget since she was elected in 2016. I'm not sure whether she is the one that gets the credit for securing a U-turn in funding for Creative Scotland, or whether it is actually down to the efforts of the STUC and the creative sector themselves. But let me move on. With the announcement today, the Deputy First Minister claims to be passing on a £700 million increase to councils, but according to IFS, when you remove ring fencing, this amounts to no more than £71 million. That's equivalent to a £304 million real terms cut. I see he's shaking his head, but you know, disagreeing with the IFS is not a clever thing to do. But I have to say, the cheek of Hamza Youssef coming to Western Bartonshire to launch his campaign when the SNP cuts are forcing the council to cut £21 million from essential services. Now, over 7,000 jobs across Scotland are under threat because of this. Councils are considering selling off buildings, outsourcing services to make savings, or even cutting back on children's services. And whoever is lucky enough to take over from Nicola Sturgeon will have to answer to striking teachers, poorly paid social care workers and their own SNP councillors who have been forced to break rank and speak out against the damage being done because they know that this budget is bad for Scotland. Now, we cannot begin to tackle the problems facing Scotland without addressing the crisis in social care. The lack of ambition for social care, which this budget displays, compounds the catastrophe that engulfs the NHS and serves to weaken social care further. The NHS crisis will not be solved if patients cannot be quickly and safely discharged when their stay in hospital comes to an end. It will also not be solved if we fail to invest in primary care, our GPs and health professionals serving our communities. There are too few GPs to cope with demand, and the BMA themselves estimate that we are 1,000 GPs short. So people will inevitably end up at A&E because they can't get seen at their local surgery. The bottleneck at the back door of our hospitals is causing long waits at A&E and lengthy ambulance waiting times because of a lack of beds. That bottleneck is entirely because of the crisis in social care. Staff vacancies are increasing exponentially as they leave in droves to take jobs in hospitality and retail. And the safety of those receiving care is being compromised as a result. The Scottish Women's Budget Group and the Coalition of Care and Support Providers have been absolutely clear that the Scottish Government must pay social care staff more than the insulting 40 pence rise that they've been given. Just yesterday, a supermarket announced it would pay staff a minimum of £11 per hour. And the SNP can't even manage to match that for social care staff. That is truly shameful. No wonder staff are demoralised and exhausted. Labour's proposals of paying an immediate £12 per hour whilst continuing the fight for 15 have been costed and they are affordable. It will make a huge difference to sustaining care in our communities. And instead of paying staff a fair wage, the SNP continue to plough ahead with a deeply flawed National Care Service bill. It lacks vision and will not make an actual difference to care. Pausing the National Care Service, funding urgent priorities like staffing, ending non-residential care charges, and increasing respite would make a real difference to care providers, to staff, to carers, and to those cared for. There are still unanswered questions around how much the National Care Service would cost in VAT. Just imagine paying 20% to the Treasury and not spending it on care. And what about the pensions of the 70,000 public sector workers who will be transferred from local government to an organisation that they know so little about? No answer from the SNP. It is not unreasonable for workers to ask who will pay their pensions and how they will do so. But the government seem to think that these people don't deserve answers to such an important detail. And where is the budget that delivers the Fair Work Nation? Where is the budget that delivers the 2019 commitment to fair work in social care? Where is the budget that will deliver on promises made to the trade unions about collective bargaining and about fair pay? It's not in this budget. It won't be in the next one. And as with so much that we have come to see from this SNP government, promise lots, deliver little. Look, even Nicola Sturgeon herself admitted that local government is struggling with the financial constraints that the SNP is handing to them. And the share of the cuts is worse than anything the SNP themselves have experienced. But Scottish people are being asked to pay more, but they're getting worse services. They're being asked to foot the bill for 15 years of neglect from the SNP to their local communities. This is an SNP government that is turning its face away from social care, an SNP government turning its face away from the crisis in the NHS in the hope that sticking plaster approaches will work, and an SNP government that's turning its face away from those struggling with a cost of living crisis. Presiding officer, an SNP government out of ideas, out of vision, and out of time. The country is crying out for change, and it's Labour that will deliver the change that Scotland needs.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. I now call on Murdo Fraser to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Around 8 minutes, please, Mr Fraser.
Well, Jackie Bailey was doing so well until she got to that final line in her speech, presiding officer. But the annual budget debates are a highlight of the parliamentary calendar. Normally that's when we hear all the party's big hitters come along and deliver their great lines. And in that respect, I think it's very disappointing that none of the candidates to be SNP leader or First Minister of Scotland, as far as I can see, even appeared in the chamber, never mind contributed to this debate. I think we had to look forward to hearing speeches from them all setting out their vision for Scotland. But never mind, because we did hear a barnstorming speech from my good friend Kenneth Gibson, who never disappoints the chamber with his colour and his energy. And I would say to Mr. Gibson, it's not too late. You have until Friday to attract the necessary nominations. We would welcome you putting your hat into the ring, Mr. Gibson, as a nomination. Now, there is something of a tradition around the budget process that dates back to Derek Mackay's time when he was finance secretary. Because what happens is, at stage one, the finance secretary comes along to the chamber and says, every single penny has been allocated. Not another penny can be found. If opposition parties want to spend more money, they need to tell us exactly where in the budget they would take it from. And as opposition parties, we say, well, what are you hiding? And they say, there's not a penny to be found. And every single year, what happens is we get to stage three and miraculously more money appears. And there was a running joke, members will recall, about Derek Mackay's well-stuffed sofa. Well, Mr. Swinney is not disappointed this year, because he's come up with an extra £125 million in Barnett consequentials, thanks to the UK government, and he's brought that money forward, he says, for more money for teachers. And we're still not clear, and if you can clarify this in his response, that would be very helpful. Does that mean a new offer is to be made to the teaching union, or is this just money backing up the offer that was already made last week, which of course has already been rejected by the EIS? So if Mr. Swinney could confirm that point when he responds, that would be very helpful. But the overall picture in relation to this budget is we have a record block grant from Westminster in the current financial year. Despite the increase in inflation, the Fraser Valder Institute have said that the budget for the coming year is more or less protected against inflation. That was before this extra money came forward. And we have a Barnett formula, of course, that delivers more than £2,000 per head of population, additional spending here in Scotland compared to the UK average. And that is extra money coming to Scotland thanks to the union dividend. And we should never forget that. Now, a budget is, as a number of members have made clear, about choices. And we set out at stage one our alternative approach. We would do things differently. The National Care Service, an estimated to cost £1.3 billion over the next 5 years, is something we would scrap. And I don't know where Emma Harper has been, but four committees of this Parliament have produced reports slamming the plan for a National Care Service and pointing out the weaknesses in it. And now, even a candidate to be First Minister, even Ash Reagan on the SNP benches, is calling for a rethink. We have a growing consensus, all the opposition parties, and now even a candidate for First Minister saying it is time to stop this plan for a National Care Service, because it doesn't add up, and that would free up resources to spend elsewhere, for example, on local government. But there's a more fundamental point about the size of the budget, because fiscal devolution means that the amount of money the Scottish Government has to spend is directly tied to the relative performance of the Scottish tax base compared to the rest of the UK. And we know that since 2014, the growth of the Scottish economy has been, on average, one half of the rate of the UK as a whole, a point I made to Mr. Mason earlier. And if we had at least matched UK growth, we'd have hundreds of millions of pounds more to spend on public services than we currently do. So tackling economic underperformance must be a priority for this government. And I was very pleased to see another candidate to be First Minister of Scotland, the current Finance Secretary, Kate Forbes, who was saying in the newspapers at the weekend that she is to put a rescue plan for the Scottish economy at the heart of our leadership campaign. The current Finance Secretary is saying we need a rescue plan to save the economy from her own government that's been in power for the last 16 years. You couldn't make it up, Presiding Officer. That's what the current Finance Secretary is saying. Now, despite the announcement today on more money for teachers' pay that we still need to get clarification on, what is happening to local government is that core funding is being cut in real terms. And we heard from a number of members across the chamber about what the real term impact of that will be, as councils have to set their budgets in the coming days and weeks. Sarah Boyack talked about the impact on the communities she represents. Miles Briggs talked about cuts in home to school transport, cuts in outdoor education. Stephen Kerr talked about the possibility of four swimming pools in Falkirk closing. Others talked about cutting recycling centre hours. Pam Duncan-Glancy talked about cuts to the third sector in Glasgow and increasing charges. That is coming from every single council in Scotland. And even SNP council leaders are revolting, presiding officer, at the prospect of what this government is going to do to them in cutting their spending. And the finance secretary, the standing finance secretary, talked about the child payment. And the child payment is welcome. As Liz Smith said, we have welcomed it. But we have to look at what else this budget will deliver for those who are disadvantaged. Because if at the same time as there is a child payment, councils are cutting breakfast clubs for disadvantaged children, they're cutting free swimming lessons for young people who therefore cannot learn to swim, they're closing libraries, they're closing arts programmes, that is no way to help the disadvantaged. What this government is doing is giving with one hand and taking away with the other in this budget. And Mr Swinney mentioned the social contract. He mentioned the fact that there are services in Scotland available free that are not available elsewhere in the UK. And that is true, insofar as it goes. But the problem is that these free services are rationed. So NHS dentistry is free in Scotland, but it's impossible to find an NHS dentist who'll give you an appointment. I had a letter this morning from a constituent in Kirkcaldy making exactly that point to me and blaming on Hamza Yousaf, yet another candidate to be First Minister. Higher education is free. But thanks to the SNP cap on numbers, many talented youngsters, as Liz Smith and Stephen Kerr said earlier, simply cannot get a place at university. We have free parking at hospitals, but it's often impossible to get a space. We have free bus travel for young people, but bus services are being cut across the country, so there are no buses for them to travel on. That's not a record to be proud of, presiding officer. Presiding officer, this budget does nothing for the economy. It's not the rescue plan that the finance secretary has called for. It doesn't deliver the 75% cut in rates for retail, hospitality and leisure businesses that apply south of the border, the same businesses which are reacting in horror at the moment to the introduction of the ruinous deposit return scheme, yet another calamity from this government. This budget does deliver higher taxes. It does deliver savage cuts to council funding. And as councils meet in the next few days and weeks to slash services, to close libraries, to close swimming pools, to cut leisure centres, to cut breakfast clubs and to cut funding to the third sector, let's be clear, it is Mr Swinney and his government that has to take responsibility for all those cuts, and that is why we cannot support this budget this afternoon and will vote against it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Fraser. I now call on Deputy First Minister John Swinney to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Government, and if you could take us to decision time, please, that would be great. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And let me begin with the remarks that Miles Briggs opened his speech with in a generous welcome to the Chamber, to James Dornan. And I think Miles Briggs, I associate myself very much with the welcome back to the Chamber of James Dornan, but Miles Briggs did so in a spirit of generosity that is necessary and appropriate in a Parliament. And frankly, we need a bit more of that in this Parliament. And I want to commend Miles Briggs for that welcome and add my words of welcome to James Dornan. It's lovely to see him back in the Parliamentary Chamber. Now, there's a few points of detail, if I can put it as mildly as that, that I'd like to correct from the statements that have been made by colleagues. Douglas Lumsden mustered up the motivation that he would have to vote against this budget because of the cut that's been made to the men's shed movement. Well, I can assure Parliament the men's shed movement have been offered the same amount of funding in the next financial year that they were given in this financial year. So there's no cut there. So Mr Lumsden has just lost one of his reasons for voting against this budget. The second reason that Mr Lumsden gave was about the condition of school buildings. Now, when this government came to office in 2007, 63% of pupils in Scotland were being taught in good or satisfactory school buildings. That's the school estate survey, 63%. I remember the former presiding officer, when he was a Labour spokesperson, lecturing me in 2007 that not a brick would be built by the SNP under our school building programme. Not a brick, were his words. Now, over 90% of school pupils are being educated in good or satisfactory school buildings. So, there's another excuse from Douglas Lumsden just removed about his ability to support the budget at decision time. Now, a number of members have commented on the situation in relation to funding for culture and the arts, and particularly Sarah Boyack, who tried to intervene on me on this point in the debate in stage one, and I was unable to take her intervention. But the difficulty facing arts and cultural organisations is of a perfect storm, where there are challenges in the public finances, there are challenges in lottery income, there's challenges in relation to the purchasing of tickets and financial support to cultural organisations because of the cost of living crisis. That is all coming together. And I have to be candid with Parliament, the government cannot solve all of those challenges. It's why I've intervened to the extent that I have today. There was no cut been made to arts and cultural organisations in the government's budget. We were asking Creative Scotland to use their reserves to provide stability, but we've put new money in there to make sure that those reserves can be used to enhance provision and to provide some of that respite in the perfect storm that is being experienced by the arts and cultural organisations. And the government will continue to act in that fashion wherever we can, of course.
Sarah Boyd.
I very much appreciate the Deputy First Minister taking intervention. If we had the time to debate this, we would, but there are other things the Scottish Government could do, like tourist visitor levy. It doesn't fix everything, but it's a modest change that could be brought if councils want to. And I will send them the report of my culture roundtable in October, because there were some very good practical suggestions made by the sector.
Deputy First
Minister. Well, I'd welcome that, and I know the Culture Minister will be happy to engage with Sarah Boyack on that point. And on the tourism visitor levy, the legislative provisions are being prepared for that to be introduced to Parliament, so Parliament will have the opportunity to scrutinise legislation on that point relatively shortly. I'm sure a measure of that type, which will empower local authorities, will be warmly welcomed by all sides of the parliamentary chamber, a bit like the working place parking levy legislation, which was so warmly welcomed by the Conservatives. Emma Roddick, I thought, made a very, very significant point in the debate when she highlighted the amount of money the government is spending in Scotland to mitigate the welfare policies of the United Kingdom government. And she put it into perhaps common parlance by illustrating that the total amount of money that the Scottish government spends on mitigating UK government welfare policies amounts to 38 times the cost of a referendum. So we could have 38 referendums. The thing that they banged on about in exchange for the welfare cuts that are being inflicted on the people of Scotland as a consequence of the UK government. So,
Alec Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. While we're on the subject of measuring things by the amount of referendum costs, can I remind him that he proposed earlier to expend twice as much on a referendum as he has for the entirety of the 200,000 sufferers of long COVID budget, and this budget does nothing to them.
Deputy First Minister.
We're spending £19 billion in the National Health Service with a £1 billion increase in this 1 year because we've taken the tough decisions on tax. Now, part of the difficulty and the challenge that lies before me, not least in the balancing of the budget this year, is the competing propositions that we hear from different sides of the chamber. So Liz Smith, for example, demanded that I spend much more of the budget on supporting the productive end of the economy, which she defined as high and middle income earners, ignoring the fact that those individuals benefit from the social contract of early learning and childcare, free personal care, free prescriptions, free eye tests, and no tuition fees for their children should they go to a Scottish university. And Pam Duncan-Glancy, who said there was nothing in this budget whatsoever to tackle inequality and managed to skate past the £450 million the government is spending on the Scottish Child Payment. So that is an illustration of the fact that the Conservatives want to undermine the budget by not supporting the agenda, the progressive tax agenda that we're taking forward. And the Labour Party don't want to support us in our journey to try to tackle inequality by measures such as the child payment. That illustrates just the scale of the absurdity of the propositions I'm facing here today.
Yes. Liz Smith?
I thank the Deputy First Minister for giving way. There is no absurdity whatsoever in many of the statistics that the forecasters have set out about the need for Scotland to have far more higher paid jobs so that we are improving productivity and attracting people to come to Scotland and to live and work in terms of all the things that they have to provide. There is no absurdity in that, because we desperately need that increase in the tax take and the productivity so that we're able to do far more things.
Deputy First Minister.
Has Liz Smith not read the Scottish Fiscal Commission's report on the budget and the tax projections, in which it makes very clear that the income earnings growth in Scotland projected over the next 5 years is a source of great encouragement? Why can't the Conservatives welcome that as an indication of the progress that's been made here in Scotland? Now, of course, much of that gets to the heart of the choices that this government has made in the budget. And, President Officer, in approving this budget, the government believes we are investing in Scotland now and in the future. The decisions of this government, created in partnership with our colleagues in the Scottish Green Party, have created a tax and benefit system in Scotland considerably more progressive than that in the rest of Great Britain. Scottish reforms to the income tax and benefit system are set to raise the incomes of households with children by around £2,000 per year on average. Now, those are not my words. Those are the words, Jackie Bailey, of the Independent Institute of Fiscal Studies. They're a vindication of the policy decisions we have taken to advance that agenda. Now, anyone that votes against this budget today is voting against the substantial steps taken by this government to use the powers of this Parliament to make Scotland a more progressive country. Of course, I'll give way.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. Given that he is quoting the IFS, in their report on the budget, they state very clearly that compared to 2009-10, the local government funding is 5% lower per person. If you strip out ring fencing, that's 8% lower. Does he recognise that analysis? And what difference does the announcement made today make to that analysis?
Cabinet Secretary.
We've kind of been round the houses this several times this afternoon. But, you know, the first point I'd make to Mr Johnson is, has he in any way obliterated from his recollection the decade of austerity that we have suffered at the hands of the Conservative government? We've been wrestling with that all the way through. And the second point is that local authority funding, and I know there's a great debate about ring fencing, but I've just announced a budget settlement that increases local authority budgets by £790 million for the forthcoming year. Why can't that be welcomed by the Labour Party in the course of this debate? Presiding Officer, the impact... Yes, I'll give way to Mr Fraser.
Murdo Fraser.
So I'm very grateful to Mr Swinney for giving way. Can I just get some clarity on this point from him? Is the extra money going to local councils to support teachers' pay, is that reinforcing the offer that's already been made to the teaching unions, which has already been rejected by the EIS, or is it there to support a fresh offer?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's there as the government's contribution to the existing offer that's been put on the table to local authorities. And I make the plea today, and you know, Mr Fraser can bang on all he wants about the teachers' pay deal, but what suggestion is Mr Fraser offering today about how much money we should put on the table for that deal and where should it come from? Because Mr Fraser has essentially spent £1 billion this afternoon and he hasn't come up with one sentence about where the money is coming from. And then Mr Fraser's got the brass neck to talk about leadership elections. He failed in every leadership election he went in to get the Conservative Party, just like he's failed in every single election to try to defeat me in Perthshire North, because I've beaten him every single living time.
Thank you.
Presiding Officer, the budget changes that I've announced today respond to the points put to me by political parties and stakeholders. Today is the day when Parliament must decide. Is Parliament prepared to put the finance in place to pay the Scottish Child Payment? Is Parliament prepared to put the resources in place to support the transition to net zero? Is Parliament prepared to put increased resources into health, education and policing to meet the needs of the public? The Government is prepared to do that in partnership with our Green Party colleagues. The challenge to the opposition parties is whether they can recognise the scale of the challenge we face and support the budget, or are they going to posture with no answers to the issues that we face as a society? I am proud to commend this budget to the Chamber, and I urge all members to support it.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Budget Scotland No. 2 Bill at Stage 3. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, and there's one question to be put as a result of today's business. And the question is that motion 7968 in the name of John Swinney on Budget Scotland's No. 2 Bill be agreed, and there will be a brief pause to allow members to access the digital voting system.